I'd like to welcome everyone to the 476th meeting of the National Science Board. This meeting is now convened at 12:45 p.m. Eastern on December 8th, 2021, via Zoom and live streamed on the board's YouTube channel. As you've noticed from our agenda, we've built on our August pilot by holding our committee meetings in advance of this meeting. As such, we'll be meeting exclusively in plenary session, both this afternoon and tomorrow. And all of the NSB committees will share report outs and lead discussions with the full board in both open and closed plenary sessions, respectively. We'll welcome two sets of guest speakers. In this opening plenary session, we have a panel of presenters speaking on the uneven geography of K through 12 STEM education. And this brings together two areas of interest for the board during year two of our Vision 2030 implementation, K through 12 STEM education and the geography of innovation. In tomorrow morning's plenary open session, we'll hear from Drs. Jose Fuentes and Kay Husbands-Feeling, who serve as chair and co-chair of the Committee on Equal Opportunities in Science and Engineering, or SEOS. They'll be sharing with us the findings of their most recent biennial report. At tomorrow morning's plenary session, we'll also hear from the Vision Implementation Working Group. They'll be sharing our NSB-wide Year 2 Vision Implementation Plan. Other highlights of this meeting include preparations for the rollout of Science and Engineering Indicators 2022 and hearing about the ASTRO 2020 Decadal Survey. So please stay with us during our open sessions over the next 2 days. I'll now turn the meeting over to NSF Director Seth Raman Panchanathan for his remarks.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and good afternoon, good morning to all of you. So if you'll indulge me, I'll just bring up my presentation here. So let me do that. And let me put it in okay, are we all able to see it? Yes.
Yes.
Great. So welcome and delighted to be with all of you here today. Since our October retreat, we have had a number of things that's been happening both inside the agency and in partnership with all of you. So just a few weeks ago, we all celebrated Thanksgiving with friends and family. And for me, usually Thanksgiving and the holidays are a time to pause, reflect, and of course be thankful. So I communicated that to the NSF staff, how grateful I am, particularly in the context of where we have been the last year and a half, truly grateful to the staff for doing a superb job in moving forward with the agency priorities, mission, and goals. So I also want to take this moment to personally thank each one of you and the exceptional staff of NSBO, because this partnership has been tremendous and I really cherish that. And so wanting to take this opportunity to communicate that as well as the holiday wishes. I'm sure we will share that through the meeting and at the end of the meeting tomorrow. You know, it's hard to believe that, I always say this, when I came in as a director, I came in a virtual mode, and it's now a year and a half and we're still virtual. Still trying to get into the virtual mode, but I am in my office. That's good. So I'm starting to come into the office more regularly now, of course, with all the precautions that we are taking. So when we met last August, I spoke to you about several ways in which NSB's vision, NSF's vision, and the administration priorities are making strategic steps forward towards our shared goals. So I always anchor to this because this is something that we collectively are working together, and I'm thrilled by that. So we are forming new partnerships and strengthening the collective resources, therefore, so, and with several bold new programs that not only have we launching, but also designing to launch all of that. And in doing all of this, I'm also thrilled to report that we have a strong support from the Hill. And this is something that we are very thankful for. And I engage with them, and I will, in my presentation today, share some of that with you also. But first, as you all are always interested in, where are we with the various things that's happening in the Hill? I thought I would partition this into three columns. The first column is, what's happening with the NSF reauthorization bills. As the Senate passed the United States Innovation and Competitiveness Act, called USICA, on June 8th, and the House passed the NSF for the Future Act on June 28th. in the spirit of building the bipartisan success, Majority Leader Schumer and Speaker Pelosi announced on November 17 that they will hold a formal conferencing process to pass a final bill as soon as possible. We are also excited to see that just last month, on November 19, the House passed its Build Back Better Act, and this bill proposes a historic investment in NSF also, in addition to the USICA that you, some of you might have been privy to. This bill provides $3.5 billion to advance fundamental research, broaden infrastructure and capacity building at HBCUs and MSIs, and establish the NSF TIP directorate. And some of these are over a five-year time frame, some of these are over a seven-year time frame. The Senate is expected to take up this bill this month, and we are all eagerly looking forward to updating you on this progress of this the Senate steps in our next meeting. And the third part, which is the federal FY22 budgeting process. Now that the federal government is funded through February 18, we are hoping that the NSF fiscal year 2022 can also continue to move to Congress. So the House passed as part of the FY22 bill, a significant increase to NSF budget, about $1.2 billion over the fiscal year 2021. In October, the Senate Appropriations Committee released 9 of their 12 FY22 spending bills, including proposed funds for NSF. And this provides about $9.49 billion for NSF, which is about $1 billion increase over FY2021. So we are very thankful to both the House and the Senate for this historic investment increases. And so we're hoping to get the final on this hopefully soon. And we all know that at the heart of these investments is a fundamental belief in NSF's mission and our vision for the future of science and technology. I keep reminding that, you know, we need to focus on these major priorities that we have all agreed upon and aligned with the vision that we talked about. So I want to highlight the three pillars again of this vision, which I have distilled into these three distinct priorities, as I said. And first, we are focused on strengthening what I call the established NSF. I've been doing fantastic work over the last 7 decades. I'm in a moment going to share one of those facets of the brilliance of those investments, which is manifested through the Nobel Prizes. So I'll share that in a moment. But for over the 7 decades that NSF has been making these investments, these have truly expanded the frontiers of knowledge and technology. This is the heart, and I keep underscoring this and repeating this, and I will say it again. This is the heart of what we do, and we will continue to make sure that this keeps us focused as a central theme of what we will be doing at NSF. Second, we are inspiring the missing millions, a very important priority that we have all agreed that is at this moment in time, exceedingly vital for the nation to push the frontiers of discovery and innovation to new heights. We all know that we need to work and partner with in all 50 states to unleash the enormous talent. Again, something that I repeat again and again that is embedded in our communities so that the new diverse perspectives are brought into the nation's scientific enterprise. And the third piece, which is the acceleration of the development of technology and innovation. And we said that partnerships is how we're going to make this happen. So the legislation from Congress, as I outlined a moment ago, is setting the stage for the creation of the new TIP directorate. But this priority extends beyond the establishment and success of the directorate, because I've always said that it permeates through all parts of NSF, leveraging, energizing. So we are really working hard to amplify, therefore, our efforts across the agency and to power technology innovation, as I say, at speed and at scale. Now, as I said earlier, the 70 years or 7 decades of powerful investments that NSF has made possible several discoveries, several inventions, and impacting a broad range of fundamental research across the various disciplines in the scientific community. More than 250 Nobel laureates whose work has been supported through our investments. Just 2 days ago, I was in the House of Sweden when the Nobel laureates received their, earlier that day in the National Academy of Sciences, their Nobel Prizes, this time because of not being in Stockholm, it's being held here, both in the East Coast and the West Coast in the NAS premises. But then we had a dinner in the House of Sweden where we celebrated the amazing work done by the Nobel laureates. And I went and personally talked to each one of them. And they were so excited by NSF's early investments and continuing investments that made possible some of their work that you see here in physiology and medicine, in economic sciences, as well as in physics, specifically this year. So for example, the 2021 Nobel Prize for Physiology and Medicine was awarded to David Julius for his discovery of receptors for temperature and touch. In 1990, NSF recognized the importance and potential power of David's research, awarding him the Presidential Young Investigators Award. That's how our lead started, and you can see the impact of all of this. And this year's Nobel Prize in Physics went to three different researchers, including Princeton University's Tsukuru Manabe, and I had a good conversation with him, as I said the other day, for his groundbreaking contributions to the physical modeling of Earth's climate and for reliably predicting global warming. Since early 1980s, NSF has been proudly investing in Dr. Manabe's research on large-scale atmospheric circulation. And finally, the Nobel Assembly also awarded the 2021 Prize in Economic Sciences to three researchers who have all been supported by NSF throughout their distinguished careers, including David Card for his empirical contributions to labor economics, Joshua Angrist and Guido Imbens for the methodological contributions to analysis of causal relationships. Over the years, the methods developed by Card, Angrist, and Imbens have been widely adopted and applied by other researchers, addressing a range of important social and economic issues. But I want to say this, these are not the only NSF researchers making bold connections between foundational research in economic sciences and the real world needs of ever-changing society. We all know that. And that's what makes us so proud of what NSF makes possible. And we are very proud of the scientific community that does a superb work and makes our nation proud and the community proud. For several decades, as I said, we have invested, and every meeting, I promise to share with you some of these exciting investments and their impacts. And I look at that as we all know, some of these happen within a decade, some couple of decades, some several decades. So this time I thought I will, in the spirit of the Nobel Prize in Economics, why not talk about applied economics work that NSF has invested in and the impact it has created. So NSF's investment in social, behavioral, and economic sciences have led to various discoveries and innovations. Here are a few examples. In the 80s, NSF awarded numerous grants to the economist Al Roth to study game theory models of markets and bargaining, interactive behavior, strategic interactions in complex environments, and two-sided matching markets. In 2004, based on this work, Roth and his colleagues established a new computerized tracking system for kidney donors. This is a well-known example, but it highlights how an entirely new field of economics can emerge from research investments. Further cementing the importance of this work, Al Roth chaired the 2012 Nobel Prize in Economics for the theory of stable allocations and the practice of market design. Upon receiving the award, Roth credited the founding of the field of market design to early NSF investments and support. In 2001, NSF-funded behavioral research showed that automatically enrolling employees in retirement savings programs like 401k dramatically increases the number of people saving for retirement. It seems intuitive, but as you can see, some of these things are well-founded based on not only the theories, but also subsequent experiments and validation. Since these findings were published, business surveys conducted in 2019 show that 69% of companies across the United States are now automatically enrolling their employees in a 401k. Additionally, legislation is being proposed that would require all employers to automatically enroll eligible workers in retirement plans. I just want to show that these are everyday impacts. That's something that we want to highlight too, in addition to all the fantastic things that happens in terms of discovering the amazing, exciting discoveries like black holes and multiverses and so on. In 2007, NSF awarded a grant to a team of researchers to study ways to increase higher education enrollment among low and moderate income families. The study tracked nearly 17,000 low-income individuals and determined that cumbersome financial aid forms like the Free Application for Student Aid, Federal Student Aid, better known as FAFSA, and a lack of information about higher education costs were creating substantial barriers to higher education. Researchers concluded that by using information that was already being processed as part of a family's tax filing, the FAFSA process could be streamlined from 13 hours to less than 10 minutes. As a result, this new approach has increased enrollment rates for high school seniors by 30% and has increased the percentage of those who receive federal grants by 33%. It also increased enrollment rates for young adults already out of high school by 20%. In response to this success, in 2012, U.S. Secretary of Education Arne Duncan announced plans to streamline FAFSA and explore ways to transfer information directly from Internal Revenue Service to an online financial aid application. You can see, you know, impacts like this, which really affect everyday activities and makes opportunities and new opportunities possible. Finally, as you know, access to affordable clean water is vital for energy generation, food cultivation, and basic life support. However, with rising drought pressures and population demands, water is an increasingly precious resource. We all know that. Starting in 1998 and continuing through 2000, NSF-funded researcher Vernon Smith did significant work in experimental economics, exploring the function and design of water markets. Similarly, in 2010, NSF-funded 7 awards under its Environment Society and Economics umbrella to foster collaboration among geoscientists and social scientists to address crucial issues for environment, society, and the economy, and assess how these three affect each other, the interplay between all of that. Founded in the ideas generated from this research, an online water leasing market called Mammoth Trading was established in 2018 with support from the NSF I-Corps grant. It provides new risk management tools for farmers, reduces the cost of water reallocation, and leads to an increase in agricultural productivity and profits while maintaining or improving environmental conditions and resource sustainability. These examples highlight how powerful the double helix of exploratory research in synergy with translational research can be creating life-changing impacts. But we can do more. We know that. And we know that there are still millions of talented and creative individuals with millions of good ideas across our nation that are not being brought into the STEM community. To tap the full potential of our nation and increase the number of STEM-enabled discoverers, it is imperative that we continue to build upon NSF's long-standing programs aimed at strengthening existing pathways to STEM and create new ones along every point of a person's STEM journey. Our future scientists, engineers, and entrepreneurs are being educated right now in our nation's schools and universities. It is critical that we prioritize STEM learning at an early age and spark curiosity-driven thinking in each and every person. Highlighted here is just a fraction of the many programs we invest in to create early exposure to science and technology throughout underrepresented groups and to connect them with the mentors, role models, and the support they need to thrive in STEM fields. By opening doors, that's why I call this the opening doors in STEM or to STEM. By opening doors to STEM education for these learners and exposing them to the power of innovative thinking, we are bringing in a new wealth of experiences, perspectives, and approaches that can spur new and exciting progress. Having opened doors, of course, we also recognize that broadening our nation's community of innovators requires more than just opening doors to STEM and to providing STEM exposure at an early age. Because of this, NSF programs like the ones that you see in this slide, we are actively addressing the question of how, once we have ignited that STEM spark, we can retain and sustain STEM talent during key transition and potential drop-off points throughout their careers. I know some of you have asked me, you know, we would like to know more about programs that's already at NSF. What are you thinking about and doing? I thought that I should start sharing some of these also. So this gives you a vignette of how we are looking at STEM inclusivity, broadening STEM participation, and things of that nature that we talk about in our meetings and trying to advance the agency to move forward at speed and scale and at strength. Time and again, NSF programs have shown that when they empower individuals to access an opportunity, their curiosity and ideas benefit not only themselves, but their peers, their communities, and the entire nation. By supporting both foundational curiosity-driven, discovery-oriented research and youth-inspired solutions-oriented research and work, we will always make transformational leaps forward in discovery and innovation. For example, since the early 1990s, NSF has been making investments in teams of researchers that have played important roles in supporting the discovery and understanding of RNA interference known as RNAi. These breakthroughs have been instrumental in advancing our understanding of plant biology and our growing capabilities to use biotechnology to strengthen agricultural output around the world. However, before it was youth-inspired technology, let's not forget, RNAi research in plants began with curiosity-driven investigations of petunias. In the 1990s, NSF-funded researcher Richard Jorgensen noticed that adding extra copies of the gene that coded for purple coloring surprisingly resulted in white flowers. While trying to understand why the purple color gene was being silenced, Jorgensen discovered a small piece of RNA that was similar to RNAs from invading viruses. Nearly a decade later, the term RNA interference was coined, and the RNAi technique began to revolutionize molecular biology research and spawn a range of applications in agriculture and medicine. So in 2008, Richard Jorgensen and a multidisciplinary team of scientists established the iPlant Collaborator. I remember that very well when I was in the board, when we looked at the funding of the iPlant Collaborator and the progress that was being made. Phenomenal project. Known today as Cyverse, this NSF-funded collaborative research platform is a critical piece of life sciences cyber infrastructure that continues to enable data sharing and collaborative research among thousands of plant scientists and research projects. And it was a similar combination of curiosity-driven research around small RNAs that led to another technology with major societal impact. We all know that. In the early 2000s, scientist Jennifer Doudna wanted to understand how bacteria guard against viral infection. Research into understanding these mechanisms revealed how viral DNA sequences are incorporated into the host gene, how these genomic inserts are used to produce small antisense RNAs, and how foreign genetic elements are selectively silenced or destroyed. The research funded by NSF over decades has led to the invention of the CRISPR-Cas gene editing system, which earned Doudna, along with Emmanuel Carpentier, a Nobel Prize in 2020. As a result of NSF's investments, going back 30 years to Jorgensen's initial curiosity-driven research, and through more recent high-profile breakthroughs like CRISPR, scientists, engineers, and farmers are now generating new techniques to push the frontiers of what is possible for crop science. From enhanced resilience to drought to pests and climate change to increasing crop yield and nutritional value, NSF's investments are spurring discoveries, innovations, and technologies that are strengthening agriculture production, combating hunger and food scarcity, and tackling major challenges facing our country and the world. One example that builds off the tremendous power of gene editing is Inari, a company founded by NSF researchers at Harvard and UCLA. Among other endeavors, the company is working with NSF-funded researchers at the Cold Spring Harbor Lab to develop crops suitable for urban environments. Another important way of supercharging the research outcomes and accelerating the cycle of discovery and innovation is by strengthening our foundation of partnerships across the country. This is something that I've been talking about since the day I came to NSF. We need to strengthen our partnerships of every type, of every kind, of every mode. Since our last meeting, I've had many conversations and meetings, and I've had the pleasure of talking to many different groups throughout the STEM community, both in person and virtually, to share NSF's mission and strengthen our partnerships. I had the honor of speaking with PCAST to share NSF's role in the future of discovery innovation and discuss ways we can collaborate with the Presidential Advisory Council of Science and Technology moving forward. I also had the opportunity to join Second Nature's Climate Action Pursuit Series to share NSF's current and future climate research priorities. I termed it the NSF's top 10 eyes on climate. And I hope to share those eyes with you with you all someday. In September, I joined the University of Wyoming President X Idel during the Wyoming Blockchain Stampede event to discuss the future of computing and education. I also participated in a fantastic panel discussion on the future of science and technology investments at Research America's National Health Research Forum with amazing fellow panelists. And for my first in-person presentation since becoming director and joining my dear fellow colleague, Dr. Elena Chowa, I had the honor of addressing the National Academy of Inventors at the 10th annual meeting in Tampa, Florida. We both did that. Finally, I was delighted to visit the US Naval Academy Science and Engineering Conference to speak, and this is in person, with future Navy and Marine Corps officers and their peers from other colleges and universities across the country. It was the most enriching experience for me. I just really enjoyed interacting with all of them, as you can already see from me, from the photo that depicts that. When I became director in summer of 2020, I joined the agency virtually, I repeat that. And until recently, I've been primarily interacting with the agency and our partners digitally, as I've said earlier. Over the last 3 months, it has been truly inspiring to start traveling again, to connect with these partners face-to-face, meet and talk to incredible NSF researchers and students, and visit several amazing innovation centers, accomplishing amazing science in communities across the country. In September, I had the pleasure of joining Congressman Frank Lucas, the ranking member of the House Science, Space, and Technology Committee on a visit to Oklahoma State University, accompanied by OSU President Casey Schramm. As well as faculty and staff from across the campus, we toured the university's premier research spaces, including the newest unmanned systems research facility in mixed reality lab. Interacted with a number of faculty and students. It was wonderful to see and hear how NSF's investments are being used by Oklahoma State's faculty and students to solve real-world challenges with innovative and groundbreaking science. Shortly after visiting Oklahoma, jumped on a plane, got to the next state, Kansas. I met Senator Jerry Moran, ranking member of the House Appropriations Commerce Justice Science Committee, to visit several institutions that are enabling incredible innovation across the state and opening doors for new and diverse STEM talent. At the Blue Valley Center for Advanced Professional Studies, a program that connects high school age students with industry and careers, Senator Moran and I spoke to students about the benefits of the program and what they hope to accomplish based on their experience. Truly amazing. That, and at the Johnson County Community College, we spoke to current and former students who have received scholarships to pursue an associate's degree in science through NSF's STEM Scholars Program. These are unbelievable students. I was so amazed. And the NSF folks have been hearing about this time and again in any meeting that I get a chance. I just tout the fact that these are amazing students that NSF is investing in the future. These two visits were powerful reminders of the tremendous capability of our community colleges and professional studies programs that have access to support and welcome talented individuals of all socioeconomic backgrounds into the STEM community. The Senator and I then visited the University of Kansas, where we toured the university's engineering labs and met with several NSF-funded research groups, faculty members, and students. During our tour, NSF was excited to announce the $4 million EBSCOR investment that will bring together researchers from Kansas and Delaware, both EBSCOR states, to improve how plastics are manufactured and recycled. It was fantastic to see firsthand the impact of the EBSCOR program and the growing scientific research capacity and STEM workforce in Kansas. In October, continuing, Senator Richard Blumenthal and I visited New Haven, Connecticut to discuss NSF's role in supporting innovation across the state and how we can foster even more partnerships among academic institutions, the state and private sector. We had the community leaders come there. We had the innovation leaders come there from the economic development agencies. It was fantastic. Both UConn and Yale leaders were there. While I was there, Senator Chris Murphy welcomed us via video, the other senator from Connecticut. And I heard many great examples of NSF support and impact from university leaders and faculty at Yale. I had a lunch with the faculty. Wherever I go, I have a lunch with the faculty at Yale who are supported by NSF to understand how things are working, what things can do, NSF can do better, how can we do better? And so it was a great visit by having representatives from academia, industry, and government. Seeing people face-to-face who have been supported by NSF throughout their careers and now embarking on promising entrepreneurial paths. It was truly rewarding and enriching. And most recently, I visited Ohio State University in October, in November. And I had the opportunity to speak with NSF-funded researchers and students about their work in the future of discovery and innovation at Ohio State University and across the country. I was also honored to join OSU President Christina Johnson, who visited me at NSF, and Representative Joyce Dady, the chairwoman of the Congressional Black Caucus, and Representative Troy Balderson, in groundbreaking ceremony for the university's new Energy Advancement and Innovation Center. The building is yet to exit another incredible state-of-the-art facility that will serve as a central hub for important multidisciplinary energy research and technology incubation. All these visits were excellent examples of the powerful innovation ecosystems that can be achieved through strong partnerships between NSF, academia, private industry, and our local communities. Throughout all my engagements, those with Congress, academia, industry, and within our own NSF community, I've been so proud to continue to emphasize the incredible work NSF makes possible. You all were asking about cool science. I thought in addition to cool science, I thought I'd also expose you to cool people who do science. And it is truly an exciting time. Every single NSF directorate and office is working to rapidly expand the frontiers of discovery and innovation across every discipline of science and engineering. And I promised you that we will share this in every meeting moving forward. Because of your excitement, I get even more excited that you are excited. So to tell you more about this progress, I would like to invite our fantastic leaders, assistant directors, Dr. Alexandra Eisen, Dr. Margaret Martinosi, and Dr. Skip Lupia, to briefly share with you some of the amazing breakthroughs that their directorates are making. So we're going to start first with Alexandra Eisen talking about discovering the breeding Southern Ocean. And I'm going to get out and get you all to enjoy the more exciting presentation by Alex.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Panchanathan. And thank you all for the opportunity to tell you a story about the ocean that we in GEO are very excited about. The ocean plays an outsized role in the future of our planet. The ocean's regulation of CO2 is like breathing. It takes up carbon dioxide in some places and it releases it in others. But how much CO2 can the ocean take up? How does this change over the seasons? These are critical questions for understanding our resilient future. So let's look into this story about how innovation is helping us quantify the ocean's breathing. Just as your smartwatch monitors your oxygen levels wherever you go, we need that same monitoring technology for the ocean. We need the ocean smartwatch, and now we have it. In the 1990s, the need to quantify the ocean's role in redistributing heat from global warming led to the development of cost-effective robotic floats. These floats made it possible to survey large areas of the oceans and map circulation patterns that move heat around the globe. In the 2000s, the need to quantify CO2 fluxes of our breathing ocean became a research imperative. In the 2010s, advances in sensors, communications, and battery technologies led to the first widespread deployments of floats that were supported by NSF to measure the breathing Southern Ocean. The transformational success of these initial deployments resulted in additional NSF investments through the Mid-Scale Research Infrastructure 2 competition that will expand the 200 floats in the Southern Ocean to an eventual 500 floats in the global ocean. NSF is leading the way in this sensing revolution, and NSF, along with our federal partners, are building the global coalition needed to bring a 1,000 float network to fruition. The commitment to open source technologies and posting of data in near real time makes this network a true global partnership. Throughout this research to translation process, NSF supported training and professional development of graduate students and early career researchers while also building industry partnerships. So how does this network work? This diagram is of one of the floats showing data transmission antenna at the top, as well as the critical sensors. Just as your smartwatch takes measurements while you move around, these floats also collect data as they freely float in the ocean currents. They start their cycle by floating at 1,000 meters for 9 days. They then descend to 2,000 meters and start their ascent to the surface, taking measurements all along the way. At the surface, they relay their data and location to shore using Iridium. The floats then descend back to 1,000 meters to drift for another 9 days. The floats can operate unattended for approximately 5 years at a cost roughly equivalent to 2 ship days. This table shows the data points collected from ships and by floats for 7-year time periods. There's a lot on this slide, but the take-home message is that the floats can collect almost 10 times the number of vertical profiles over a similar time frame and at a much lower cost. So what has this technology told us so far? So let's first look to the initial deployments in the Southern Ocean around Antarctica. Our previous paradigm was that the Southern Ocean was a significant year-round CO2 sink that would help counter increased anthropogenic carbon dioxide. In the past, weaker winds drew undersaturated water to the surface, resulting in the ocean breathing in CO2 from the atmosphere. However, this hypothesis was developed using data that were heavily biased to summer shipboard observations. With the addition of the austral winter data from the robotic floats, we now have evidence that the winter Southern Ocean may be breathing out CO2 from the deep ocean as higher winds tap carbon-rich waters. And this finding has significant implications for our reliance on the ocean as a potential sink for anthropogenic CO2. Another exciting result from the floats that was published last week as the cover story of Nature Climate Change is that not only is the Southern Ocean getting warmer, as shown in the vertical crosscut of the ocean on the left, the ocean's also circulating faster, as shown on the crosscut of the same area on the right. This is an unexpected result that provides evidence that the exchange of properties between the ocean basins may be accelerating. So in conclusion, these are exciting times where technology is allowing us to sense the breathing ocean. This capability is essential for being able to accurately predict the ocean's role in our global resilient future. So thank you for your time. And I'd now like to introduce Dr. Margaret Martinosi for our next presentation.
Thank you, Alex. And let me share my screen. Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Margaret Martinosi, and I lead the Computer and Information Science and Engineering, or SIES, Directorate at NSF. You've all seen this image from 2 years ago. It captivated me, it captivated us, it captivated the world when it made front page news. Lots of different scientific facilities, techniques, researchers, and topic areas contributed to this iconic image. It was a point of pride for NSF and for scientists worldwide. Today, I want to zoom in on one of the topic areas that contributed to this accomplishment, computational photography. From physical scanning techniques to subsequent algorithmic analyses, computational photography refers to a wide and convergent range of techniques that compute on collected data in ways that make it possible to see things better, or in cases like the black hole, to see the otherwise unseeable. For example, one key to imaging the black hole was the CHIRP algorithm developed by Dr. Katie Bauman and her collaborators. CHIRP stands for Continuous High Resolution Image Reconstruction Using Patch Priors. It uses probabilistic analysis, Bayesian approaches, to infer information from radio telescope data around the globe in order to help fill in the collected data to gain the needed resolution. Across NSF's portfolio, there's a range of investments that are advancing computational photography. Across all of these, information is gathered and analyzed in ways that help create faster or better imaging. What varies in these projects are the different information types that are being sensed, the different analysis mechanisms that are invented to advance the visualization, and other constraints posed by specific aspects of the research, such as sometimes a desire for real-time processing. Medical imaging is one place where it's important to help see the otherwise unseeable. As part of her NSF Career Award, Professor Heidi Sierra at University of Puerto Rico, Mayagüez, is developing 3D optical imaging models and is applying them to different imaging scenarios, including environmental remote sensing as well as deep imaging of live tissue. In particular, her work integrates the material's optical properties into the analysis to improve image resolution performance. Work led by researchers at Rice University is seeking to make high-resolution medical imaging more tractable by using computational techniques to prune away less important light paths from an image. This work is part of a $10 million size expedition in computing award entitled Seeing Beneath the Skin. This project also includes renowned privacy and fairness expert, Dr. LaTanya Sweeney, to advance towards techniques that work well across many demographic groups. So what about reading the unreadable? Work done by Brent Seals and others at the University of Kentucky develops computational techniques to read ancient scrolls too fragile to unroll. Starting from micro CT images, Seals' unprecedented work developed revolutionary software for locating and mapping the 2D surfaces, the layers of the scroll that I'm pointing at here, within a 3D object, the rolled up scroll itself. That is, Seals' work unwraps the scroll virtually instead of physically. Applying his techniques to the Dead Sea Scroll fragments shown here, Seals also has methods for automatic colorization to achieve high resolution. You can see the ink that he's sort of highlighted here, at tractable speeds. With techniques like these, he has been able to virtually read some of the oldest biblical texts in the world. Seals has paved the way for a broad set of digital analysis techniques for cultural heritage. Across all these projects, we see them advancing convergently towards use-inspired goals, while also providing general computational approaches that, like a Swiss Army knife, can be applied to other discovery goals across a wide range of topic areas. This interplay of use-inspired and discovery is really at the heart of the DNA double helix that Dr. Panchanathan's talks highlight. Excuse me. As with most cool science stories, the end of the story is never really the end, just a new beginning. So looking ahead, what's next? Well, for one, Dr. Seals and his Kentucky collaborators recently received a $14 million NSF Mid-Scale Research Infrastructure Award with which to advance their heritage science approaches. Of particular note is his collaboration with Kentucky's Mammoth Cave site in order to explore the many human uses of that area over millennia. And with respect to that black hole image, another iconic image from that news cycle is this one of Katie Bauman, the leader of the CHIRP algorithmic effort. This year, SCIES is pleased to have awarded Katie Bauman, now a Caltech assistant professor, her career award for co-optimized sensing and reconstruction for next generation computational cameras. So we look forward to what's next. Thanks very much. And over to you, Skip.
Thank you, Margaret. It's wonderful to see everyone. At NSF, we ask big questions. Questions like, how can we improve quality of life for every American? We take on these questions by working together. We draw expertise from all areas of science and engineering. And NSF's strategic investments in the social, behavioral, and economic sciences directorate, as Dr. Panchanathan described earlier, play a vital role in this mission. Today, we see so many great examples of SBE researchers making important discoveries and helping all of us build better tomorrows. With this strategy, SBE empowers people across the country to SBE the solution. That's our strategy. Be the solution. Here are two examples of the strategy at work. Many people struggle to get accurate information on COVID-19, particularly people in underserved areas who are frequent targets of misinformation. Big question, how can we help more people protect their families and their communities? NSF-supported researchers took an innovative approach to this question. Drawing on previous work in psychology and economics, they ran a massive experiment in India that is now paying dividends in the US. Their experiment involved sending a text message to 25 million randomly selected people in the Indian state of West Bengal, pictured in red on the map. Each message featured a video from Nobel Prize winner, SBE awardee, and West Bengal native, Abhijit Banerjee. In the video, Banerjee asked viewers to report their COVID-related symptoms, which matters because there was a very strong social stigma against reporting symptoms at the time. He also discussed other COVID-reducing behaviors. A separate control group in the experiment was sent a link to a government website with a lot of the same information, but no video. So what happened next? Within days of the messages being sent, health officials in areas that received the message reported a doubling in the number of COVID-related symptoms being reported. This is a massive increase compared to areas that did not receive the messages. Health officials also saw significant increases in protective health behaviors, such as hand washing and avoiding crowded areas. The messages had a huge effect. The researchers then partnered with Harvard, MIT, Mass General, and others to run a similar experiment in the US. Over 18,000 Americans participated. The American videos contained messages from doctors of different races and genders. The researchers wanted to know if factors like these could increase the message's impact. As in India, the American experiment showed significant effects on COVID-related knowledge and decisions. Another valuable finding was that the content of the doctor's message mattered much more than what they looked like. This work suggests that even in today's complicated world, American doctors have broad credibility. Results like this show the life-saving power of knowing who can be a trusted source during a public health crisis. And these findings are empowering more people all over the world to be the solution in our attempts to battle pandemics. Now let's talk about the translational power of neurons. Most of us take for granted the amazing dexterity of our hands and fingers and everything they allow us to do. But people who have lost a hand or an arm, including some of our nation's veterans, face daily challenges that most of us do not. Prosthetics can help, but many amputees have muscle paralysis, which limits the functionality of today's prosthetics. For these people, prosthetics are nowhere near as responsive as human hands and fingers. Big question, can we improve quality of life for our friends and neighbors? And the answer is yes. Earlier this year, NSF-supported researchers working at the intersection of behavioral science, neuroscience, engineering, and cognitive science announced a big advance. They were studying how neurons translate signals from nerve cells to muscles. The researchers identified new ways to capture signals that come from the tiny nerve cells. They then used computational techniques to crack the code on how the tiny signals correspond to neurons that control key muscles. With cracked code in hand, they built a small device that translates the tiny signals into individual finger movements. With the device, just thinking about moving a particular finger moves the corresponding animated finger. This is a first. This incredible finding can open new worlds for people who rely on prosthetics and people whose muscle limitations are due to strokes. It's an amazing advance. And what's next? Future steps involve working with partners to be the solution to develop usable versions of these devices at scale. There are so many other stories to tell, and our success owes so much to the NSB, to your vision, and to your guidance. So let's continue to work together to empower people across our great nation to translate, to innovate, and to be the solution. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Skip and Margaret and Alex. I hope all of you had a good sort of overview of the kinds of exciting science that's happening at NSF. So I will now like to conclude through the rest, few more things to say, and then we'll then get done. So let me do that. Okay, talking about Skip. I tell you before we get to Skip, this is the kind of leadership that you all, I'm sure, are very proud of. I'm very proud of every day at NSF. The amazing leaders who are making possible unbelievable innovations across the nation. They're constantly challenging themselves and their teams to see how they can innovate more through programs, through projects, through new ideas. And so it's truly a rewarding experience working with these amazing colleagues. But then when you work with amazing colleagues, sometimes, like Skip, they try to skip. And so Skip is a phenomenal leader. I got to know Skip when I was a board member, when he gave his first talk, and I was just blown away. I remember that day very well. And some of the board members may recall that too. So his term is coming to an end next week. And keeping with the SBE theme, the S, he is a strong scholar and a strong support to me. Has always been since the day I arrived here. And he's brilliant, we all know that. You know, in the community, if you go and talk about Skip at the SBE community, including my advisory committee conversations I had just 2 days ago, the SBE advisory committee, they all speak so highly of Skip, rightly so. And in the E, the excellent execution that he has, the amazing skills he has and excellent execution. You know, we'll miss that a lot, Skip. I hope you'll all join me in thanking him for his service over the last 3.5 years. His hard work, his dedication, his leadership. I mean, there are not enough thanks for the wonderful work that Skip has done. And thank you, sir. I know that, as I say with NSF, once you're touched by NSF, you can never get away from it. So that's what it is. I'm sorry. That's what it is. Skip, we look forward to working with you in many other capacities and your engagement with NSF in the future. So thank you. Talking about another fantastic leader, we have Susie Iacono, who also retired in September, post our last meeting. Susie has also been a superb leader, a tremendous leader. And in a farewell party, I said the best way of describing Susie for me is the wisdom that she always brings to any discussion, to anything that we do at NSF. I always look up to Susie and her wisdom. That's because of the fact that not only she is intellectually an amazing individual, but also has spent 23 amazing years with the agency. So when you have that kind of an experience combined with the intellect that Susie possesses, it is just a phenomenal combination. And Susie has been an amazing leader for NSF, has contributed in so many ways, not only to NSF, but also to the scientific enterprise. So both Susie and Skip's contributions to the nation's scientific enterprise will no doubt resonate through the agency and the nation for a very long time. So let's take a moment to congratulate both of them on the retirement. We will miss you guys. So to celebrate the tremendous progress we made last year, I thought the best way, again, because of Cool Science theme, I thought another vignette of looking at, you know, the great things that happened in 2021. And so I would like to end today's talk by a short video highlighting the many discoveries that our research and investments made possible through 2021. And so here we go.
2021 has been a year of discovery, innovation, and trailblazing science.
I'm not able to hear the sound. Can anybody else hear?
No, there's no sound confirmed. I think we need to make sure that he's actually shared the audio on his.
Yeah, make sure he shared the audio from his machine, otherwise it won't work.
Punch, there's still no sound for the video. Not sure if something can be done. Otherwise, the link can perhaps be put in chat.
I learned that the audio was not there. Is that right?
That's correct.
That's correct.
My sincere apologies. I just got to know that. So what we will do is in the break, if somebody's interested, we'll play the video again. And otherwise, we will share the video with you so that you'll have a chance to look at it too. And we'll post it to make sure that everybody gets a chance to see it in the public. Sorry about that. I don't know what happened here, but we'll fix it.
I think most of us were able to read the captions.
So yeah, that's right. Closed captions always close. You never know when it comes to comes to rescue here. So that's good. I want to say, you know, I just want to conclude by saying I'm so grateful for the partnership between NSF and the Natural Science Board. All of this would not be possible unless we have this rich partnership. And your advice, your counsel, and your oversight makes us do our work better. So this success that you're seeing is all possible because of this rich partnership. As we enter the new year, I'm really excited about where we are heading with the many things that we have planned for not only the next year, but the years to come. So thank you again for the opportunity to share with you today. And I look forward to the rest of the meeting, Madam Chair. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much, Panch. And really, there's no better way to start a National Science Board meeting than to hear these examples of exciting research in science and engineering. So thank you so much to Alex, Margaret, and Skip for those fantastic examples. And to your update, all your activities, Panch, but also those great examples of where we are benefiting positively today in our society from the investments that were made by NSF, including those made many decades ago. And you talked about Skip and Susie, so I certainly must say, and I know I speak for the whole board, when to say they will both be hugely missed. Skip helped us greatly improve some of our work, especially the Skilled Technical Workforce Report and our Vision 2030 report. Susie has been an extremely valued partner, particularly as we looked more closely at broader impacts, but also in many other areas. So thank you for highlighting them, and we're happy to add to that as well. So let me see if we have members that have any questions for you. I don't see any raised hands. So with that, we will take a short break and we will meet back at 1:50. At that time, we'll continue an open session with the panel on the uneven geography of K-12 STEM education. And we can go to the coffee breakout room during this break if we want. And I think we'll, as you said, Panch, have the opportunity to see the video.
Yep, I will share the video then.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, come on and then show me how to do it. We should have done this.
I think it was the one.
Sorry about that.
Yeah. No, it's fine.
Hey, Panch, this is Steve. Are you still there?
Hey, Panch, you're on open mic.
He's muted.
I was just wondering, what time did Alan say we're reconvening?
When you share the video?
1:50.
1:50. Oh, okay. That's pretty good. Thanks.
While the director is working through his movie, I just wanted to welcome the panelists. If you could turn on your video. I just want to make sure that your video is working and your audio as well. So, Randy, can you just unmute? I just want to hear your voice there for a second.
Hi, Alexandria. How are you?
Perfect. Sounds great. Pam, you're next.
Hello. Yes. Have a good afternoon.
It's great to see you. Michael?
Hello. How's my sound?
Perfect. And Eric? I see he's here.
There we are. Can you see me?
Hold on one second. I need to scroll through everyone. Yes, and I can hear you as well. Thank you so much. Thanks, okay. Everyone, for showing up nice and early so we can do the sound check. And we look forward to the panel in 5 minutes.
We'll check the YouTube, please.
Yes, Anne.
We had some work done by St.
And Chris, can you let me know when we're recording again?
will do. We're working on a side piece real quick. Angel, are we good?
Yes, we are live now.
Okay, Madam Chair, we are recording you live.
We'll now turn to our external panel on the uneven geography of K through 12 STEM education. These panels have become a mainstay of our board meetings, providing data and context on timely topics that assist us in developing and honing our work in accomplishing the vision goals. Today's panel is the second in our series on the geography of innovation, which started with August's panel on community colleges. I'm grateful to former board member and former chair of the board's External Engagement Committee, Jerry Richmond, for working closely with board member Roger Beachy to ensure a seamless transition in leadership of these panels. Today's panel will highlight the differences and similarities in rural and urban K through 12 STEM in-school programs, the role of experiential learning both in and out of classrooms, and the strengths and roadblocks in these communities, irrespective of their geographic location, in providing STEM learning opportunities for all students. I'll now ask Suresh Babu, as the new chair of the External Engagement Committee, to kick us off. Suresh?
Thanks, Ellen. Hello, everyone, and welcome to our panel on the uneven geography of K to 12 STEM education. Before we start, I would like to ask board members and others in attendance to please turn off your cameras and mute your microphones during the presentations. As Ellen said, thanks to Jerry's leadership, these impactful panels of external experts have become staple of our meetings. With Jerry's recent departure from the board, we are grateful to Roger for stepping in to assume the leadership of developing and organizing these panels, starting with this one. As many of you know, among his many other areas of expertise, Roger is both passionate and experienced in issues pertaining to the geography of innovation. Roger was part of the National Academy's consensus report that evaluated EBSCO. And as many of you may recall, Roger pushed the board to embark on Vision 2030, of which expanding the geography of innovation is a key element. Roger, thank you for assuming leadership of these important panels. We are excited to hear from the speakers you have assembled and to a robust discussion after the presentations. Please take it away, Roger.
Thanks very much, Suresh. And I should start by saying, you know, this was a team effort that was led by members of our outstanding board office, and that we'll talk about that you all have that you've met previously. And I'm really pleased to chair this panel on a topic that many of us on the board are deeply interested in, yet lack important information about. This, by learning more, we'll know more about what our how to set expectations for the NSF and some goals to be set too. We have an exciting panel that should generate a vigorous discussion. It's been a pleasure getting to know a bit about each of them as we prepared for today's event. Alexandra and Nadine and Reba have done just an outstanding job in getting us having us prepared appropriately for this board presentation. The board's vision for the 2030 scope that we talked about earlier highlights the need for a strong STEM workforce, which in turn is dependent on the STEM education that starts in grade school. The board's recent elementary and secondary STEM education indicators report, again, showed for the 10th year, I believe, a lackluster performance of students on standardized tests in science and math that has largely remained unchanged over this period. In addition, longstanding disparities persist across racial ethnic and socioeconomic groups, and have worsened during the pandemic, as we know. The board called in its Vision 2030 for an all hands on deck approach to modernize K through 12 STEM education. But what does that mean? And recognizing that geography plays a significant role in STEM education that our children may receive, we first need to understand quite literally the lay of the land and hear from experts who can speak about the strengths of local communities and approaches that can be amplified. Today's panel builds on our August panel that showed how community colleges are an essential component of the nation's STEM education system, providing access to STEM and serving as S&E hubs across the country. In contrast, today's panelists will highlight data, community culture, and successful strategies such as experiential learning to develop rigorous STEM curricula and to train students in critical STEM thinking. Each panelist will speak for 5 minutes, after which we'll have a Q&A section. It's limited in time, so let's keep our questions coming, but brief. We'll start off our session with Pam Buffington, Dr. Buffington, who is herself a resident of a rural state, Maine, is the U.S. Division Director of Rural STEM Initiatives at the Education Development Center, and is a national expert in rural and mathematics education. Pam will highlight data on rural STEM programming, the strengths of rural communities, and the needs of rural America in bolstering STEM K through 12 education. Our second speaker, Brandi Hutterson, is an assistant professor of biology at the University of the District of Columbia. Dr. Hutterson is co-author of studies on urban STEM education. Brandi will provide data and insights of urban STEM K through 12 education, highlighting the strengths and the needs of urban communities for a strong STEM K through 12 education. Our third panelist is Eric Jolly. He's president and chief executive officer of the St. Paul, Minnesota Foundation. Dr. Jolly chaired the 2015 National Academies of Science report entitled Identifying and Supporting Productive STEM Programs in Out-of-School Settings. Eric will talk about the efficacy of STEM programming, out-of-school education opportunities across different communities. Our final panelist is Michael Garaya. Michael is an Albert Einstein Distinguished Educator Fellow at NASA at the present time. He will share his experiences as a STEM educator in Baltimore County and the importance of STEM experiential learning methods and how that's been applied in his region. Now, at the end of the presentation, as I mentioned, you'll be given an opportunity to turn to ask questions back, and that'll start the STEM, the Q&A. But now I'll first turn to Pam to start her presentation. Pam, it's off.
Thank you, Roger. I grew up in a rural community and attended rural schools and have spent much of my adult life with rural educators and leaders. My expertise in STEM started early and was associated with my daily rural life and routines. It was a context full of fabrication, tinkering, and applied practice. We had workhorses, and when my father explained how to hook the chain to a log to pull it out of the woods, he said, connect it like this to create a spin force called torque, which will make it easier for the horse to pull. These experiences undoubtedly contributed to my degrees in mathematics and physics education. While not all experiences are the same, it is essential that we reframe the deficit narrative of rural people and places and focus on access to resources, opportunities, and address economic inequality across people and place. Rural residents and their context vary greatly based on location, geographic and community assets, and local economies. Rural schools and communities are not monolithic. They're culturally, racially, and ethnically diverse. They reflect inequitable access to rich STEM learning opportunities. 1 in 4 students in rural communities is a student of color. And in many rural districts, students of color are the majority, such as in districts in Arizona, Florida, Mississippi, Nevada, Oklahoma. Over 9.3 million students attend rural schools. That is over half of all districts in the country and more than enrollments in New York City, LA, Chicago, and the next 75 largest school districts combined. To address economic and social vitality of the country, We must recognize both the assets and unique challenges facing rural schools, communities, and people, as well as the critical role STEM knowledge, skills, and experiences play in their lives. Historic employment is disappearing or changing with shifts in fishing, farming, forestry, and energy production, which heightens the need and demand for qualified STEM individuals to rebuild the economy and sense of place. Next slide. But there are real challenges. If we continue to ignore them, we'll have dire consequences. Rural schools often lack state-of-the-art technological tools and resources and affordable broadband connectivity. This lack of affordable access to broadband infrastructure, a reality that became much more visible during the pandemic, severely restricts STEM education and career opportunities. Rural schools also face barriers in preparing, recruiting, and retaining STEM educators and leaders, contributing to a severe gap in access to high-quality STEM education, further contributing to the disparity in STEM preparedness. Rural schools do not receive adequate funding. While funding comes from a variety of sources at federal, state, and local levels, almost half are based on local property taxes. Current levels of income inequality exacerbate underfunding of rural schools in some of the most economically depressed areas of the country, as 8 in 10 counties in the U.S. experiencing persistent poverty are rural counties. Rural counties are also disproportionately impacted by climate change and extreme weather events, as they are highly dependent upon natural resources that are affected by climate change. Next slide. Rural STEM education success occurs when we leverage strong relationships, acknowledge a commitment to place, and embrace multi-generational connections to the school as community center. Rural community members are keenly aware of and connected to the places in which they live and work. They have deep and applied STEM knowledge. In collaboration with schools and place-based educational projects, community members can contribute to the development of students' STEM skills and understandings. Community members working in the natural settings often recognize the subtle and ongoing changes in the environment well before formal research is undertaken. They can work with educators and students to collect and analyze data and enhance data skills critical to understanding local issues and contributing to solutions. So my recommendations include: reinforce authentic and place-based connections to the community with a commitment to equity and culturally responsive practice. Support innovative recruitment and retention strategies and increase targeted funding for rural STEM professional learning. Increase STEM education collaborative partnerships and external learning opportunities between rural educators, community members, increasing upskilling activities. Target funding for rural higher education access for community colleges, preparation and training for rural educators focusing on STEM domains and careers, and support access to higher level STEM experiences through online enrollment. And finally, increase funding for state-of-the-art technological tools, resources, connectivity, and professional learning for high quality use in rural schools and communities. Thanks.
Pam, thank you very much for that presentation. We look forward to some discussion following. Next turn to Brandy. Brandy, would you please start your presentation? Thanks.
That's the previous, yes. Good afternoon, and thank you for the invitation to present today. In order to fully understand urban STEM education, we need to clearly articulate what is considered to be urban. In this context, urban does not follow the U.S. Census Bureau's definition of urban and urbanized areas, which is based in part on population size. Instead, in the education arena, the classification of urban is based on an accumulation of characteristics thought to provide an inclusive definition of urban education. We can discuss public urban education as learning centers that exist in metropolitan areas where there's a tendency for increased cultural and linguistic diversity, as well as socioeconomic diversity. These learning centers tend to have large enrollment and larger student to teacher ratios. It is also important to take into account the microenvironment of these schools. For example, there may exist schools where there's a more homogenous student population with variety in the socioeconomic status of the students, or the student body population is highly diverse with their community being poverty, with their commonality being poverty status. According to Urban Education in America, it is estimated that there are approximately 15 million K through 12 students attending public urban schools. Next slide, please. In the United States, there are several barriers facing urban STEM education. An overall examination of funding for urban STEM for urban-focused STEM programs showed an overall lack of cohesiveness at both the national and local levels, with many target populations being oversampled and overburdened with duplicative programming across federal agencies. To provide a little context, in 2012, the GAO reported that across 13 federal agencies with STEM education programs, there was an approximate 80% overlap between program services and target populations. Structurally, there's a lack of supplies and resources and general investment from school systems. Teachers and instructors are provided with insufficient professional development opportunities, which feeds into poor content knowledge and delivery and inefficient assessment, leaving many students feeling unprepared to persist in STEM. Cultural and psychological barriers can exist in many forms and at times can provide the most formidable barrier. One example of a cultural barrier can be seen with educators who may be unfamiliar with the culture and language of the student population. A review of the literature published by Hill et al. In 2012 found that many pre-service teachers who were not from urban areas had limited experience with cultures and languages other than their own. Another example can be seen with the lack of culturally relevant curriculums. Much of our current educational benchmarks have been adopted from Western curriculums and may not have a local relevance. This can lead to further disconnect for students as they may see no connection between themselves and their lived experience and what is being taught in the classroom. Psychological barriers in some ways can be seen as an extension of or even a result of cultural barriers. Students in urban public schools are often victims of harmful preconceived ideas about both their ability and desire to learn. These preconceptions can manifest in the classroom in the form of lowered expectations from educators. These lowered expectations can affect the rigor of presented contents, as some may feel that these students are unable to grasp complex concepts or excel in their academic performances. This can negatively affect how students see themselves, leading to lowered expectations of their own academic performance and presenting outward as a general disinterest in academic achievement. Next slide, please. So what has worked and how do we mitigate these barriers? So here I present four examples of programs that have proven to be, that have proven to work in the past. So STEM-focused after-school programs. With approximately 7 million children participating in these programs, out-of-school programs have the opportunity to impact and shape the interests of students traditionally underrepresented in STEM. After-school programs allow students the opportunity to learn through solving problems and failing through firsthand, materials-rich, and place-based learning experiences that involve processes of scientific or engineering investigation and practice. The use of culturally relevant curriculum. Development and implementation of STEM curriculum that allows students to center their lived experiences and, as explained by Gloria Latson Billing, maintain their cultural integrity. The use of culturally relevant curriculum facilitates a connection between the content and the learners. A key component of this is teacher training, specifically embedding cultural awareness in teacher training and professional development, and actively addressing and removing pedagogy based on bias and exclusion. Inclusive STEM schools. These specialty schools can exist as standalone schools or as schools within a school and have been seen as a more inclusive alternative to highly selective STEM-focused schools. Inclusive STEM schools base their admittance on students' interest in STEM subjects as opposed to test and academic performance. And finally, bridge programs. Also referred to as college prep or summer bridge programs are low-cost intensive programs for STEM disciplines to prepare students to meet academic demands of STEM degree programs and to address non-academic factors that may contribute to the attrition of students in STEM. These programs focus on students who may be less likely to be prepared for college coursework, working to increase their basic subject matter understanding, increase their understanding of fundamentals, and gain access to resources and community support. Thank you.
Brandy, thank you very much. That last slide is pretty impactful with some things that have worked and things that we can learn from. Thank you very much. Our next presenter is Eric Jolly. Eric, the time is yours.
Thank you. I'd like to talk about the expanding role of out-of-school and after-school programs in achieving a pathway towards STEM careers. Earlier research suggested that there were three common focal points essential for STEM career progress. The first one, of course, is engagement, having an orientation to interest in belief in your ability to achieve and what we would now call STEM identity. If you have STEM identity, it's a great way to get started in pursuing STEM knowledge, but capacity requires the teacher professional development, curriculum, high quality materials and resources so that a learner can advance to ever more rigorous disciplinary knowledge. If you have an interested, engaged, STEM-oriented learner who has fine access to good quality materials, but the systems don't support them, if there is no AP calculus in their school or other things are missing, then without systems, they also won't advance. But when we have all three, we see student progress. Now, early on, after these reports came out, we saw a lot of the informal education systems, those in out-of-school and after-school programs, like museums, library programs, viewing themselves as only focused on that one component of engagement. They saw themselves as iterative and recursive, non-sequential learning environments that didn't have aspirations for curriculum. That has changed in the last 10 years significantly. Today, we have sequential, rich in STEM programs in America. In a survey of over 31,000 households engaged in out-of-school, after-school programming, parents identified the following attributes: social skills being developed in 90% of those programs, physical activity in 85% of the programs, and stunningly, STEM learning opportunities in 73% of those programs. And that's an increase in the study of was 2020. That's an increase from a 2014 study of only 69%. We continue to see rich in STEM programs with libraries, museums, community centers, and the rest. Primary areas of STEM, we see mathematics overwhelmingly, 62% of the STEM activity in out-of-school programs is math. Engineering is growing from 30% 6 years ago to now 39%, and science is at 49%. Could I have the next slide, please? A 2015 report, which I co-chaired, asked the questions of what was effective under what circumstance, and quite frankly, the research was thin. But now we've seen a burgeoning of that research. In a recent study of 160 STEM sites across 11 states, we found that students engaged in out-of-school and after-school activities boosted their career knowledge significantly. In 80% of the cases, 78% increased their interest in STEM, and 73% boosted their sense of efficacy. Which programs were effective? Clearly, those that had longer duration. When a program reaches 4 weeks, we get a sharp elbow in the learning curve that shows staying power. And now we find that these programs are not only effective, but they're getting value to parents. Parents are now prioritizing STEM out-of-school learning activities more than ever before. In 2014, we had already reached 53% of parents surveyed saying, yes, STEM is important to the out-of-school, after-school programs that we give our kids exposure to. Today, 2020, is 72%. Sadly, though, there's been a huge impact of COVID. 65% of parents report a quality decrease in their students' STEM learning in out-of-school and in-school programmings during the times of COVID. But clearly, these programs are important. They work, they get kids excited and interested in STEM careers, they teach them the pathway, and they give them curriculum to help them achieve more. Next slide, please. But what we have access to is uneven. Among the top quintile of public school attending families, versus the lower quintile, we find that affluent families provide $3,600 per child for out-of-school, after-school programmings per year, and less affluent families, the lower quintile, less than $700 per child. A summer camp in STEM averages $317 per week across the nation. Most families, the median family, can afford a 2.9-week STEM engagement. Summer camps that are non-STEM are a bargain by comparison at $164 per week. We need to be concerned. We need to be concerned because according to recent surveys, cost, transportation, and availability is the greatest impediment to students' engagement in out-of-school and after-school STEM. In 2014, 10.2 million children were enrolled in after-school programming. In 2020, that number has dropped to 7.8 million. We see income differentials and quintiles that negatively affect students, particularly in technology and engineering. The poorer students, only 27% have a tech and engineering component to their out-of-school programming, where 44% of more affluent students have that access. 33% of poorer students are in computer programming. 48% of affluent students are in computer programming. The numbers for science are a little closer, 43% and 57%, and math is spot on even at 65% having programs in that. And so there are points of light. 21st century learning centers provide access to students. In 2 years, we've seen a 20% increase in student math proficiency, and these programs serve over 50% of their population are BIPOC, 38% are rural and town. And 70% receive free or reduced lunch. The average expenditure per student is $1,800 per year. Among our other points of light are citizen science programs and new curriculum in out-of-school, after-school programming. I'll stop there and we'll talk about part two next time we meet.
Thanks very much, Eric. The data are pretty clear and we appreciate you bringing them to us. The fourth speaker is Michael Garaya. Michael, the time is yours. We're pretty much on time, but a few seconds late, but we wait for your presentation. Thanks very much.
Sounds good. Thank you, Dr. Beachy. First, a sincere thank you to the NSF. Were it not for the foundation, I'd probably still be engineering away in my cubicle. But in 2006, I discovered my passion for education by participating in an NSF-funded partnership between the University of Maryland and Baltimore County Public School System, aimed at getting STEM professionals like me into teaching. I've been in education ever since, both in public and private school, so thank you for thinking creatively about pathways to the classroom and helping people like me find their niche. And I'd be remiss if I didn't also thank NASA, my host agency, and the Department of Energy, who sponsors the Einstein Fellowship. When thinking about the geography of STEM education, oftentimes the barriers come to mind first. But I'd like to focus on the positive aspects. I'm speaking to you now from Baltimore, Maryland, and front and center in STEM education here is the Chesapeake Bay. It provides a rich context for STEM education, and the best educators know it's fertile ground for integrating other subjects. In K through five education here, for example, there's an emphasis on the indigenous people of the region and the relationship between people and this natural resource. And this is just one example of something called place-based education, or using the locality as a foundation for instruction. Place-based education should provide an opportunity for an immersive learning experience and a connection to community. I'll give you another example. NASA has a citizen science project called Mosquito Habitat Mapper. Through a phone app, volunteers can report potential mosquito habitat and the presence of mosquito larvae. Paired with satellite observations of temperature, water, and vegetation, scientists can forecast a community's risk for mosquito-borne diseases. I was tasked with developing a two-week university-level resource with Shaw University and HBCU in North Carolina. When I got going, I saw a map of the distribution of HBCUs and a map of the distribution of mosquitoes, and they were almost indistinguishable from one another, in that most HBCUs are in the southeastern United States, which tends to be warm and wet, which is favorable for mosquitoes. And so I knew this connection was going to play a vital resource in the role that I developed, specifically with respect to which human populations are at most risk of infection from mosquito-borne illness. In this unit, students select from options of action projects depending upon their interest. It could be asking a scientific question about their region and using the data collected to attempt to answer that question, or it could be some sort of public outreach campaign where they visit their local K-12 school to provide information about how to minimize the risk of mosquito-borne diseases in their community. And so regardless of the option they select, students are doing and contributing to real science. They're collecting and analyzing real data while also considering how the reality of their discoveries impacts their community. I provide these examples to suggest that geography can have a positive impact on STEM outcomes for students. And more importantly, in my mind, that using this sense of place or home as a context for learning can lead to greater sense of purpose in one's community and greater stewardship of that place. Not every locality has the Chesapeake Bay, but every place has some ordinary asset, be it natural, cultural, or even industrial. And when schools are more connected to their communities through these assets, they're more likely to receive support, and the community receives the value of that investment. So you have this opportunity to create a virtuous cycle. If we want future generations that are going to be able to solve the problems that threaten their health and prosperity, place-based education is one tool that we can employ. And so how do we foster more of this? I think it starts with passionate, remarkable teachers. There are many out there already, but we need more of them. To that end, we need to continue to elevate the profession such that our best and brightest are drawn to it and are well prepared and supported to succeed. Programs like the one I participated in 15 years ago can certainly help with this, along with new programs that attract and support diverse teacher candidates and strengthen cultural competencies. Passionate, diverse educators are not enough. As I said, there are many of them out there already. However, they require resources, time, and the opportunity to collaborate. Thinking about that citizen science resource that I developed, it was only possible because I had access to the NASA subject matter experts and citizen science leaders, and we had time to iterate the resource collaboratively. I wasn't hamstrung by grading and planning for 150 students and lunch duty, et cetera. A teacher's passion can only really play out in the classroom when they're not constrained nor controlled by rigid curricula or other mandates. Teachers need to be offered the freedom to be creative. And I argue that when that happens, you will have more robust learning experiences for students that simultaneously benefit the community. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. Illuminating, to say the least. Do we have a full screen shot? We have time for questions. I think we're due to finish in just over half an hour, 40 minutes, I believe. So we've adequate time for questions. There's already one up, so I won't start with mine, but turn to Melvin. Dr. Huff? You're muted.
What do you find that is different about out-of-school programs that achieve success that can't be implemented in in-school programs?
Michael, is that directed to Michael?
All
the panelists. Michael, do you want to start since you're the most recent?
And then I was going to defer to Eric on that regarding out of school. Most of my experience is in school.
So there are a lot of things that are different. One is that we've relieved the student from evaluation apprehension. We find that that's been a significant impact, which is differentially felt by students of color over white students. So that's one of the things that's distinct and different. You can actually simply explore and learn. It allows for more self-pacing than most programs do. The other thing that happens in out-of-school and after-school programming is students select their interest area within STEM. Finally, I think a part of what we're seeing happening is we have more time. Quite frankly, of the waking hours of a student, only 20% are spent during the school day in school. Other times are great times to capture it. If you take into account the time that children spend sleeping, eating, occasionally bathing, they spend less than 8% of their life in school before they graduate from high school. that leaves a tremendous opportunity for learning outside of the standard rigorous school curriculum. And so freeing students to have, taking the part of the day which they have more time, which is volitional, which has less stress and more interest, is one of the greatest ways to engage students in STEM learning. And that's difficult in our high stakes testing environments of schools where teachers are on the spot. And we often, as my friend Shirley Malcolm says, spend more time weighing our babies than we do feeding them.
Thanks very much, Eric. Pam?
Yeah, I'd like to just add, actually during the pandemic, one of the benefits that became obvious was the opportunities to do more external learning opportunities through online and other types of engagements. And that is an area that a lot of schools are starting to really focus in on, and some state education agencies are putting more emphasis on work that provide opportunities for externships, internships, and other types of collaborative engagements with local workers and businesses. And that's been really beneficial in some of the rural contexts that I work in. So I think it's an and kind of situation where, in fact, if the flexibility in the looking at the schedule differently and providing more of those opportunities to do place-based, more project-oriented types of engagements in STEM, we're seeing very positive results there, including when students have voice in that and choice in what they're doing, much like Eric was pointing out in the out-of-school opportunities.
Thank you.
Can I also add to that,
Brandy, sure.
So I think in addition to what Eric said about relieving some of the constraints for the classroom, I think it also, these after-school programs have more freedom to design their programs around to address specific cultures. I think the programs can be designed so that they are delivered in different languages, which may be more suitable for the students. So it can really act as a support system to the classroom by giving them this more specialized curriculum.
Thank you. Michael, do you want to add to that, or shall I move to the next question?
I could just add, I know that NASA, through Science Activation, we have a lot of different programs that are after school, and they are being met with a lot of success, getting a lot of students engaged and interested in science and STEM more broadly. And I know something that Eric mentioned earlier, this notion of STEM identity or you know, believing that you can succeed in STEM is really a key focus in some of these programs, and it can be pretty powerful.
Thank you. Next is Matt. Matt's question.
Thanks.
Matt Malcolm.
So one of the suggestions that was made, it's interesting, is maybe our STEM curriculum needs to be improved. For example, Brandy mentioned specifically making it more culturally relevant. Now, I want to think about that a little bit. I can certainly see some advantage to that, clearly in humanities and social sciences. To me, in STEM, it's not so obvious. And so in other words, I'd have to be sold on this concept, particularly when you're talking about fundamental things such as math, physical sciences, chemistry. We got a lot to cover anyway, just to get to the basics. Now, I'd like to see evidence that this actually works. And I'm not just talking about improving students' attitudes, that they're more interested in STEM, they know more about STEM opportunities. Those are good things. I want to see more concrete results of the more culturally relevant, math and science curriculum, such as, for example, are the students doing better in those courses? Are they taking more courses, more advanced courses? Are they more likely maybe to end up majoring in or going to college and then pursuing those, perhaps even to a college degree? I mean, those are concrete things which might change my mind and say, oh, okay, maybe that's a key lever that we have to push. But I remain to be sold on that idea.
Brandy, do you want to take a first shot at this?
Yes. So I think it's important to understand that when we're talking about culturally relevant curriculum, we're not talking about changing the fundamentals. We're talking about adjusting how the information is being presented. So if we are in, for example, I'm from southeastern Louisiana. So we have a lot of water parishes. So if we're presenting information to students about things like climate change, the effects of climate change, if we can relate that to their experiences in the water parishes, if we can talk about things in the context of coastal erosion, or we can talk about how it's affecting our food sources, which are things like shrimp and fish. That's what I mean. So it's not changing the fundamentals that we're teaching to the students, it's helping them to understand them through their experiences. So there is some data that exists about, that exists examining how this is, how these differences in presentation affect student outcomes. I think it's also important to remember that when we are evaluating these changes in the curriculum, that we are also using the appropriate evaluation tools so that we're also asking the appropriate questions of the students so that we can actually get the information that we can actually glean the information that we're trying to understand from the students.
Anyone else like to add to that, to Brandy's discussion? Or
I'd be happy to. This is Eric. I think it's an important question that you're asking. There has been some evidence, if we look at the reviews of the statewide systemic initiatives and the curriculums that were developed and implemented around education in Alaska, were significantly different than those that we saw in Texas, especially rural Texas. And they each had positive outcomes, not because there's a different math, science, or chemistry happening in one part of the country than another, but there are, as Brandy has pointed out, different metaphors being used. And when we start to speak in the metaphors that are familiar to the students, they begin to get more engaged and they understand the programs. Any 12-year-old basket weaver on my reservation understands of their material, whether they're twisting it and where it will break and what kind of reed they're using, shear compression and torsional stress. They understand the elastic limit of the material. And so therefore they understand Hooke's law, but they didn't know they knew it because at 12 years old, those aren't the words that we use. Those weren't the metaphors we presented. That's where I think we need to go, is looking at in rural America, vastly different experiences than we see in urban America. I recall once screening through some questions for the SAT, and they wanted to know why standing on grass with a bare foot felt cooler than standing on dirt. And in the urban environment, that would be a really interesting question to ask a child to learn, because it is not in their experience. So when we use the metaphor and experience of our students, we give them a chance to show off the knowledge base that they've acquired.
Thanks. Those are all good pieces of information. I do want to mention, I'm sorry, go ahead, Maureen.
Oh, I just wanted my, I'm speaking out of order, but my question follows up directly on what we were just discussing. Could I just ask a follow-up?
Surely.
Thank you. So I appreciate the notion of kind of tailoring curriculum to students' individual experiences, but I think I kind of share Matt's concern that may apply in a very homogeneous school district, but you know, Brandy, as I'm sure you're aware, you know, in DC, you have such a spectrum of different cultures and the experiences of the students are really gonna be radically different based on, you know, what's their background and the homes they're coming from. So how do you apply this concept of kind of culturally relevant programming to truly diverse populations of students, you know, without essentially making it, I don't know, culturally relevant to the majority minorities or kind of losing everybody because it's not really relevant to anyone's personal experience.
So I think the key to this is to not dismiss a student's approach to a problem or to a topic. So it's impossible to cater a curriculum to an individual, and it's unfair to ask educators to do that. But what we can do is we can ask that we create a space that allows students to bring in their own perception and their own understanding of the content that's being taught. So if the example for physics, like Eric said, is understanding the basket weavers are using those examples, that we make space for those examples. If understanding torque and pressure, if the students understand that in terms of creating race cars or creating mechanical pulleys, because that's what they're communities as that's what they've learned from their community, then allowing them to bring those experiences into the classroom. I think at the heart of things, culturally relevant curriculum is basically creating space for other ways of knowing, for other ways of understanding. And so we can't demonize a student because in their mind, it's not 1 + 2, it's 2 + 1, right? So making sure that they are able to express those small differences when we are presenting the information to them.
Maureen, was that helpful?
Thank you. That was extremely helpful. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
I think putting space into a curriculum is a challenge when there's so much material that also has to occupy that same space. But still, yeah. I appreciate that answer. It's very clarified in my mind. Thank you.
And I would suggest that space can be found in the time out of school, not just in school.
Got it. Good.
I just want to reinforce that idea, and another couple of examples of that is the importance of the collection and analysis of data and using different examples and contexts to understand the social aspects of the communities in which kids are working. So for example, we have one project, which is an extreme weather project called WeatherX, where students analyze data from a mountain within their region of the country, but they get to go and look at their local data, pull down their local data, and then relate it to specific interests within their particular context. So what does this weather data look like within the context of the extreme storms and connections to their own interests in the community, like fishing or whatever? So it's really thinking about the examples and the context that we're bringing into the work with the same type of high quality, rigorous STEM engagement.
Thank you, Pam. The next question is to Michael, is that you? Sorry.
Yeah, if I may, I was just going to add, and this might be a little bit too local, but to your point, Maureen, about curriculum, you know, it often depends on how the curriculum is written and who writes the curriculum. And in Baltimore County, for example, it serves about 110,000 students. I've taught in two different schools in Baltimore County, one being majority Black students and the other school being about 25% each of white, Hispanic, Black, and Burmese. And I was on the team that wrote the curriculum. So you can imagine trying to write a curriculum that could serve kind of both of those schools, right? And of course, the diversity of other schools that exist within the county, it's hard. And so therefore, I would argue that it's more important to, again, give individual teachers who are going to know their class the best, right? Give them the autonomy to create what's best for their students. They know their students. And when they're too confined or constrained by rigid curricula, it's harder to do.
Thank you. Next question is from Suresh.
I have a question to Professor Brandy. The one which works is STEM-focused after-school programs. One of the critical need for that, you need volunteers and mentors with the contextual working with the students. How can we scale this across the country? So do you see this as a challenge or not a challenge, having contextual mentorship?
I think it can be a challenge, but I think there are many ways to address the challenges. I think it's, one, strategic partnerships. So I think this is where we engage industry, we engage academic institutions of higher education, especially the public institutions for higher ed, help them to reinvest in their communities. These are the communities that are supporting them. These are their tax dollars that are supporting them. So having them to reinvest in these communities. I think we can pull from undergraduate students, we can pull from graduate students to bring them into this process as well. A lot of graduate students are interested in teaching. A lot of STEM graduate students are interested in teaching. So help them, bring them into the space where they're allowed to teach and communicate with these students. I think bringing in industry helps facilitate resources. It helps to, it helps with inputs to design. It helps to think about what the workforce needs now and what is predicted to need in the future, so we can expose the students to these things. And at the end, I think it also provides role models for the students. It allows them to see people working in these different fields. It allows them to get an idea of what they can do with these degrees, which at a higher education level is a problem. Lots of our students don't know this. They don't know what they can do with their degrees. So in addition to having to reassure their foundation, having to try to move them through this curriculum, we're also trying to tell them retrospectively what they can do with this degree because they don't know.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Thank you. Julia?
Yes, so I believe I'm the only science board member who is from a really rural area that is at least 3 hours from anything that is a city of sort of 100,000 or more. And so isolation of some of those rural areas, lack of broadband access, raises a lot of questions about access to out-of-school programs, for example. Also raises questions about access to qualified science teachers. And you know, online things are great, but you have to have broadband. So I'm wondering what Pam and Eric, I think in particular, may have in response in terms of thoughts about that.
Well, I can start because I think that what happens in lots of rural communities, you're absolutely right, that the highest priority item for educators across the country currently in a national survey that we just conducted was recruiting and retaining STEM teachers, particularly science and math teachers. So you're absolutely right, and the data supports that. What we find, however, is that often inside the classrooms, people think about science as very narrowly defined. And so they don't tap into the expertise in the community in the ways that they could build much more rich opportunities. For example, in Maine, we have some different projects through the Gulf of Maine Research Center, Real World, Real Science, for example, where they tap into the fishermen, as well as the clam diggers and worm diggers around invasive species. So they really tap into the deep expertise of the marine ecology within that community from people who are there every day working with that data. So it doesn't overcome the lack of teachers that we have. We still need to provide more innovative opportunities to recruit and retain rural teachers, including things around housing and other types of approaches. But we also are not taking full advantage because some of the restrictions that others here have talked about in terms of rigid schedules and ideas of keeping everything inside the classroom walls. And so that's really critical, Julia.
And I would simply support everything Pam has said. There's no denying broadband access is a critical issue for quality education around the nation, and we need to start attending to it. But we also need to break out of the school and do, as Pam says, find alternative ways to engage the community in the teaching of young people. This has happened. We saw that in Maine, it was with SALT, a project from many decades ago. We've seen it in Appalachia. We're seeing it now in rural districts in South and Central America through programming that's happening out of the Cornell Lab of Ornithology. They've taken citizen science and used it as a tool to provide resources to classroom teachers so that the kids are bridging their out-of-school learning and bringing in data inside the school and contributing to international science databases for data mining, which gives them incredible applications for mathematics learning as well. So we need to look at models that aren't curriculum based in a book. That's long since gone, and we can find other ways by connecting to citizen science in particular.
Thanks, Eric. If I could just take follow on from that, with this challenges of finding educators remaining where they have experience, and moving on, as Pam suggested, what we need to do to hold, what needs to be done to hold talent together. Are there generational challenges that you've seen in teachers? I mean, and Michael and Pam have mentioned this turnover. Are these generational things? Are younger teachers more likely to be engaged and have more modern ways of understanding how science is taught? I mean, are schools of education, those that NSF supports, are they doing their job differently than they were and giving you better teachers that last longer?
Well, I think in the rural context, we do have a really nice model where teachers that are have been in the profession for a number of years combine with and work with colleagues that are younger. An issue in the rural schools, however, is that we have a mobility problem where we'll have teachers, new teachers come to the school, stay in the school for 2 or 3 years, have a professional certificate, and then have urban flight or suburban flight, where they are paid more for their time, as well as have access to other resources. So yes, in fact, we have new ideas. I think part of it is opening up the structure of what's possible in education. Some of the funding that came out of the US Department of Ed this last year called Rethinking Education within the context of COVID really has opened up the opportunities for outdoor education, makerspaces, and other things that are based on looking at the school schedule differently. But we have to have some real resources put to preparing and then providing structures that support them to stay in these schools as well.
Thanks, Pam. Vic, I think you're next.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Roger. And thanks to all the panel members, and a special shout out to Dr. Hutterson, who's my colleague over at the University of the District of Columbia. This is a question because to Eric, but any of the other panelists can chime in. But Eric, you talked about these three pillars that are important, and one of them was experiences. A couple of years ago, our board here, our colleagues, we got together and we looked at the value of the skilled technical workforce. These are people who have used STEM skills but don't have college degrees, people who are electricians, plumbers, IT folks. And actually, they are the larger proportion of the STEM population, according to the National Center on Science and Engineering Statistics. Have you ever thought, you know, it's as we sometimes call in the vernacular, blue collar STEM, worked with the local trade unions and trades who right now, for example, electricians, there's about 100,000 person shortage across the country. And the skills and equipment they use are far different than what we would think of the electrician 50 years ago. They use a lot of thermal imaging. They do a lot of Laplace transforms. They do a lot of coding, but you don't need a degree. But as the NSF director said earlier about multiple pathways to STEM, you could think of this as one pathway for a large proportion of students where they can get hands-on experience and have that. Have any of you all thought about that one aspect in terms of getting more students, whether at the high school level or middle or grade school level, in terms of getting involved and interested in STEM from the experiences of the trades?
I want to thank you for that question, because I think it leads to a lot of creative thoughts that we should be pursuing, but I can't say that I'm aware of many programs that do it in that manner. We are seeing a real effort to recruit into those disciplines through our community college systems in several states that I work with. And we're still seeing the same problem of workforce shortages that we're seeing across all STEM disciplines, whether they would be blue collar STEM or white collar STEM. And so we haven't cracked that yet, which I think is a fascinating challenge. The other side of that question is, how do we use people in those disciplines as ambassadors towards
yes,
STEM?
Yes, yes, yes.
That's the part of your question that presents a great challenge. And I'm now going to bring that to the next meeting of Association of Science and Technology Centers. So thank you.
It's an issue that certainly has come up in conversation among rural experts and researchers. And Hobart Harmon and Jerry Johnson have started working with some folks in Australia to look at models to provide pathways for what we have called middle skill technical workforce. Mm-hmm. So in addition to making sure that there are AP opportunities for students in rural schools, there's also a real effort to make sure that pathways are not closed off for students going to community college and acquiring those middle skills as well. So those are some areas where we can explore models in other countries, particularly Australia.
I just want to just interject and then Roger, turn it back. But if you can make a connection, and history has shown us this before, and Julia, my colleague on the board, you know, in another life, we worked at a place called Bell Labs. But in the 20s and 30s and 40s, the communication systems were all mechanical. And so they really went out to the rural areas because the people they needed were people who had worked in, who had mechanical aptitude. And a lot of people from the rural areas worked on farms and things like that. That's where they went. If there's a way with where we have the demand now for workers, we can find those shared experiences. And that's why I really liked what Dr. Hutterson and what you said, Eric, connect those experiences to these new areas of opportunity, then it might provide a narrative in being able to attract more students.
I think there's also a social component to that as well. I think somewhere around my, between middle school and high school, there was a push to be a doctor, a lawyer, a teacher, something that had a four-year degree plus. And so we kind of pulled students away from these technical jobs. A lot of vocational programs did not persist. And so the students have, we're pushing students into college, into four-year, two-year institutions that may not need to be there. They may be much happier, much more successful in other careers. We're not giving them that space. And so I think there needs to be a messaging change from the very beginning to the end about these are other careers. These are very valid careers. These they are productive. They pay well, which I think is really important to students who are experiencing poverty. And so, but we don't do that. We push students to become doctors. We have students that enter into four-year degrees and don't know about PhDs and master's degrees, but they know about MDs, dental vets. So I think there needs to be a reframing of this at the very beginning of the educational process.
Thank you very much. There's a vigorous discussion going on in chats or comments made. I hope you all are reading those as we go through this panel as well. Mel, do you have a second brief question? I have.
Yes. What percentage of students are signing up for these out-of-school programs, and what's the distribution among different groups who are signing up?
Start with anybody who's got an answer right quick.
Sure. So one in three students nationwide have access to out-of-school after-school programs. For each one that's engaged in an out-of-school after-school program, there's a list of students that are on the waiting list. The shortest waiting list is in Vermont, where there's one student for everyone enrolled in an out-of-school program. The longest is Utah, where there are 8 students on the waiting list for every one slot filled. And while we talk about there being access to out-of-school, after-school learning for up to 75% of the students, only 1 in 3 parents have awareness and capacity to access those programs. So they are oversubscribed and underpresented.
Thank you, Eric. Good answer. Others? Others? We go to Suresh.
Yeah. Hi. Since Vermont was brought up, you know, I'll take all the credit for that. And Dan Reed, you're the other end of the scale, so go figure. Hey, and Julia, we're very, very rural too. So I really enjoyed the presentations. You know, I wonder if there's a way to capture folks like you as resources. I don't know if they can have a little database in NSB or NSF. We keep having these great groups present, and maybe under different headings, if you're all open to it, it'd be nice to sort of have your contact info. So maybe not publicly available, but to the board members, that perhaps as things come up even a year from now or so, we could reach out to you. The question I had was particularly for Pam. The very last slide, Pam, you showed had some good ideas. I guess my question is, who is it targeted to? Who are those suggestions targeted to? And really the question is, in so many cases, it seems like we do well with anecdotal things. There are small sort of localized research elements or studies. I'm just wondering if you have ideas about how one scales this up. The state governments, the local governments, there's potentially federal government foundations, et cetera, et cetera. But Have you thought about a way to actually make this something that is scaled up, scalable nationwide and be provided where it's not available today? Thank you.
Well, I think one thing that is critical is really to understand the complexity of the issue and the ability to reinforce some of these strategies across locations and projects as well as funding sources. So for example, Brandy, myself, Eric, Michael, all of us have recognized in the research the really powerful nature of tapping into place and culture as a critical theme that has to go through curricula, professional development, and so on. And so to be able to leverage that and have particular understandings of what that looks like in different contexts, that may not be the best to use a competitive grant program in a rural place, but maybe be a different type of funding. So the idea of thinking about how do these ideas scale is to first have targeted funding to make sure that there's adequate research to be able to point to and evidence that these exist, and then integrate that into different grant programs and strategies. I think that one of the things that has been a critical missing link for at least the last decade and a half, if not longer, is the shift to not have targeted professional development funding. Everything is tied to, we do a lot of work, and NSF has funded incredible programs, and oftentimes they don't scale as far as they could because there are not funds specifically targeting the professional development of educators to utilize those. So there are some nuggets in those recommendations that I think are both policy recommendations and programmatic recommendations.
Thank you very much, Pam. Others want to add to that? I should mention the follow-up to Suresh's question, I think. There will be online resources that are being made available by the presenters today that I think will be helpful for those of us who want to pursue additional information. And that'll be part of what you'll get as a board. So I hope you'll continue to do that. That really was a good sort of lead in, Pam, to this whole question of how can NSF help? How could resources be directed to take successful programs and magnify them, spread them? Are there other ideas that the four of you have? We've got a few minutes left, just about five or six. Do sort of final thoughts for each of you about how the NSF can help facilitate the successful programs that you've described or address challenges, what additional research should be done or what can be done in pedagogy or how can we stop, if it's you or Brandy that mentioned the overlap between agencies, there's too many duplicating and not thought-provoking overlap. Ideas from each of you? Do you want to start, Pam? And then we'll go right down the line.
Yeah, there's one thing that's an interesting model that I'll just use Maine, but it's happening in other places too, that there is actually the ability to have what are called seed funding so that you have a whole directory or database of these types of programs with a research base that then have targeted funding that's available to iterate on those programs. In other words, we know that it works in this setting through this particular targeted funding. That is available with X number of dollars to take it and put it into your context and implement it. So for example, building off of those kinds of place-based examples that we have all referenced, but Michael was talking about, for example, there are a number of those citizen science initiatives in the Gulf of Maine, in Maryland and so on, that those are existing, but there are not the funds targeted to actually move those into the field. So really taking advantage of what NSF and others have funded over time. The other thing is to not focus completely on, as I said, having funding that's competitive in nature for those that are the least resources, have the least abilities with grant programmers to support the kind of applications that are required, providing more flexibility and partnerships so that we can leverage those resources with lower resource communities. Those are some of the examples.
Thank you. Brandy?
So I totally agree with Pam. I think that taking the data that already exists and building on that data with application and not collection of more data, I think our students are at a point now where we need to be putting plans to work. I don't think we can wait another 5 or 10 years because the numbers are not changing. And so I think that the concentration needs to be on implementing programs. I think that they're, in terms of STEM teachers, and STEM educators in K-12, I think there can be a push to provide them with stronger professional development and not just sitting in a class or sitting in a week session, but how do we partner them with, how do we create partnerships for them with different STEM professionals so that they can experience the full STEM enterprise, and that has a trickle down effect into their classrooms.
Good, thanks very much. Eric.
I'd suggest there are some really wonderful resources. America After 3 p.m. did a STEM report in August of 2021, worth looking at. The After School Alliance has a lot of data around these things, but a few things that I would support, hope NSF would support. Creating a research infrastructure available through universities to support out-of-school and after-school programming, because you're asking the people who are doing the programming to also have a level of expertise in evaluation research that they don't have and is not a keen use of their talents. Expand the role of citizen science. Citizen Science Association in the United States founded, I think 8 years ago or so, I should know I was there, had an argument. We were debating, what's the focus on community-informed science and what's the focus on helping research scientists and laboratories gain their data. Because of the scarcity of resources, we haven't helped them expand from those questions to how do you disseminate? How do you engage more broadly? How do you create networks so that we can do both and instead of one or? And then finally, I just want to give a one plus to Pam's idea. We need to make our resources more easily accessible to those who are doing the work, but not professional grant writers.
Thank you. Good. One more question for, a comment from Michael, then Dan has a question. I have a couple of remarks.
Yeah, I would say focusing on teacher quality is really important. And so things like the Robert Noyce Teacher Scholarship Program or PAIMS, those types of things that elevate the profession and get more kind of high quality individuals into the profession is really important. So continuing to fund and support those efforts are really important.
Thank you, Mark. Dan, you have a question that I didn't see earlier.
Well, it's more a comment. I just wrote in the chat. I want to connect it to something that Suresh said. I mean, and really related, Roger, to something I think you were trying to say earlier. We're talking about a systemic structural problem here. And in some sense, we know things that are effective interventions, but we have no mechanism to replicate them holistically at the national scale. And it seems to me, unless we solve that problem, we're going to keep talking around the margins. So some of this is how federal agencies change how they behave. But some of it is an artifact, and I don't want to wade into the morass of local school district control because many people have died in that quicksand. But it is part of our national challenge relative to global competition. So it feels like we need to raise the discussion up like three levels higher and talk about how we change our national approach. Otherwise, I fear we're going to keep having these discussions about here are great ideas, and these are all great ideas, and they're clearly effective, but scale is the key to success. And I'll climb off my soapbox now, but that's kind of what I worry about.
I don't disagree at all with what you said, Dan. The question of more studies or waiting until we have the solution to how to scale more. And meanwhile, waiting for more of the examples like what Pam and all of our panel have said today needs to be dispersed. And I don't know the best way to do it either. So we have examples of what can work and be effective. This was a really fantastic panel. I've only got two more minutes. Actually, I'm out of time. But again, a reminder that there are resources on additional things will be made available to the board, additional reading materials. I want to thank the board for the challenging questions that you ask our panel. But I also want to thank the panel for being prepared for this and leading to this really energetic conversation that has benefited those. I hope it's helped you all as much as it's helped us. We've long known that K-12 education is a vital piece of the puzzle that has to be addressed to strengthen our position as that global S&E keystone nation and to provide at the same time economic benefits to every American. So the board will continue its work. It's grateful for your contributions to our discussion. It will be truly helpful as we move forward. But before I close, I want to thank once again the wonderful team at the NSB that worked together with me to identify the panelists and then worked with them to hone the message in the way that's most useful to us. Alexandra, Nadine, Reba, and others, you guys are great. And we'll see how the next one comes. But we've got everything to be grateful for today for the work that they've done to lead to this panel. So thanks again, everyone, for what you've done. A round of applause for our panelists and for yourselves for the questions. It was a good hour and a half spent. So Suresh, back to you.
I think I'm supposed to just say thank you very much and I believe give it back to Ellen.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Roger. And of course, a big thank you to Pam, Brandy, Eric, and Michael. For your important information, sharing your expertise with us, and to everybody on the board for the lively discussion that we had. I hope we can continue to engage with you as we move forward with our own efforts on this critical issue. I'd like to spend a few minutes talking a little bit about my activities since our August meeting. On November 1st, I had the opportunity, as Panch mentioned, to speak at the National Academy of Inventors, where I shared highlights of the board's Vision 2030 report, key actions over the past year, and where the board is headed. I outlined our roadmap, our focus areas for the board, and emphasized the importance of developing STEM talent at all educational levels, from skilled technical workers to PhD researchers, and how all of us in the science and engineering community must do more to recruit and retain particularly those underrepresented groups in STEM. I also highlighted the alignment between Vision 2030, the NSF's vision and administration priorities, and that the board, in close collaboration with the NSF director and his team, have been working to advance our shared goals. I had the opportunity to thank the National Academy of Inventors for hosting one of our Vision 2030 listening sessions a couple of years ago. Panch also gave a keynote at the NAI annual meeting, as he mentioned. It was celebrating its 10th anniversary, and I wanted to congratulate Panch for receiving one of the NAI's Founders Awards, given to those who were instrumental in the establishment and success of the National Academy of Inventors. Alan Stern and I met with Dr. Eric Lander and his then chief of staff in early September to deliver the board approved slate of potential NSB appointees for their consideration. We had a productive conversation. I also took the opportunity to stress the urgency of filling Maria Zuber and Jerry Richmond's currently vacant seats. I'm hopeful for timely appointments there and for the next class of NSB members to join us next year. I also had an opportunity for a quick catch up with Maria as a co-chair of PCAS to ensure that we have open communications there. Last week, Vic and I published an essay in Issues in Science and Technology focused on the urgent need to cultivate diverse domestic STEM talent and emphasizing that it's the foundation on which discoveries, competitiveness, and security are built. And Nadine shared the article with the alumni listserv this week. Are there any questions or comments on that? So at this point, we're gonna take an extended break, probably lunchtime for those on the West Coast, maybe tea or coffee time for those on the East. We will reconvene in plenary open session again at 4:40 p.m. Eastern time. Please join us then for reports from the Committees on Science and Engineering Policy and External Engagement. And for board members, please move to the coffee break room by 3:45 Eastern. Thank you.
Thanks, Angel, if you'll give me host back. Okay, let's see, who do we need to have assigned here? It looks like Dario, Anila, are you able to get into the coffee room?
I don't see it. Yeah, this is Dario.
Yeah, Dario, let me send that to you real quick here. Okay.
Okay, I see it now.
Yeah, I don't see it either. Sorry, I was muted. This is Anila.
I'm going to assign you to a different room, but do not accept it, okay? Because then I need to reassign you.
Okay.
So just, I'm going to assign you to the NSBO staff one. Just ignore that, and then I'll reassign you to the correct one.
Okay.
Now, let me go back and reassign you. So this one you can accept. This is to the correct one.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, Chris, are you still there?
I am here.
Got a quick question for you.
Just an alert to everybody. It sounds like the audio is still on the YouTube live stream. So there's the lag still continuing. If somebody can confirm whenever that is ceases, it would be great.
Yeah.
Sorry, Anne, I just want to make sure everyone's still aware.
I want to wait to ask that question until we are.
Okay.
Chris, this is Andrea.
May, are you there? I'm sorry, was that May speaking? I can't tell by the screen.
No, that was Andrea. Go ahead, ask.
Oh, May. Okay. May Aiden, are you on? And Eduardo? Let me see. I think I just want to make sure May gets into the coffee room for the presentation.
Chris, when do you actually want, Treva, when do you actually want us to move into the coffee room for that?
Well, actually, I'm glad you mentioned that. So, I'd say between 3:40 and 3:45.
Yes, that's correct. This is Andrea.
Yeah.
So Chris, I'm also on that list. I'm not sure when I'm headed there. This is Carol Robbins.
So sometime between 3:40 and 3:45, we'll start making sure everybody from NCSCS is put into the board members' coffee break room.
Okay. Thank you, Chris. I appreciate it.
Chris, that I assume works. That is true also for the NSBO staff who need to go in there.
Yes, that is correct.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, my course is saying the audio is still live, by the way.
Yeah, on YouTube, it's still live apparently.
Chris, this is Steve. So we're really not reconvening till 4:40 Eastern time?
That is correct for the next continuation of the open session, I should say.
That's 3:40 my time, I guess. I'm in Des Moines this week.
Oh, okay.
So just make sure I sometimes these times.
If you can, I'm sorry, think it through. Steve, if you can actually be in the coffee room at 3:45.
Yes.
That would be great.
3:45 Eastern time.
Yes.
Eastern time, yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, you can move me whenever you want, and I could turn off the video, eat lunch, and put it back on at 3:45.
Yeah.
Let me see. It looks like you are actually already assigned, but somehow you missed the notification. It only stays on for like 3 seconds. So I'm gonna move you to the NSBO staff one, and you can ignore that.
Okay. Just like
you're in the NSBO staff, I can reassign you to the correct one.
Okay. I'll hang tight.
So let's see. I just
so I see that pop up, but I'm skipping in. Oh,
yeah. And then okay, now I'm going to assign you to the regular coffee one.
Got it. Okay. Thanks.
You bet.
And I'll make sure I'm on by 3:45.
Great. Right, thanks, bye-bye. Steve.
Yep. Bye.
Can anyone confirm if audio is still coming through on YouTube?
Coming through before shift.
Okay. I see Shana says they're working on the issue.
We're working on the issue, Chris. Stand by.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Let me know how I can help if you need anything. It's Andrea.
Okay.
Hi, Chris. Can you turn your camera on?
Yep, sure can.
Okay, we're doing a there test. You go. Keep 1, 2, 3. Can you say 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3?
1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Okay, stand by 1 second. Okay, Chris, okay. Stand by. We're still live. Okay. Stand by.
Okay, I see Chris.
Hi, Chris. How are you?
I'm good. Amy, how are you?
I'm good. Hey, I was wondering if maybe this would be a good time to go through some of my slides, or is that not a good time? Is this not a good time?
Well, right now, normally it would be, but we're having a problem with the YouTube live stream. It's not actually pausing.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
Yeah, MIMS is working on that at the moment.
Okay, Chris, I apologize for interrupting. Could you please give host control to Angel?
I will do that right now.
Thank you.
Hey, Chris, are you here?
Hey, John. Okay. We're still live streaming.
Yep. If any members of the executive leadership team show up and are interested in joining the lunchroom, they are welcome to do so.
Okay, we'll keep an eye out.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hey, Chris, your audio is kind of garbled. Just wanted to let you know.
I've been told that already once today. I'm not sure if it's just my lack of bandwidth periodically or not.
I don't know. It was garbled at the beginning of the meeting, and then it was fine, and now it's back. So I just, if someone's already told you, that's fine.
Thank you.
Hey, Chris, I don't know if you want to, if it's too early to start moving the NSBO folks who are joining us for the, as well as the NCSCS people, or you want to wait for a couple more minutes into the copy room.
Or can we move ourselves there?
We're not assigned to the board copy room.
Oh, I have a little thing that says I can join, I guess, but maybe that's because I'm co-host.
Maybe.
Okay. You said close to 3:45, right, Chris?
Between 3:40 and 3:45. And currently, I don't even have co-host, so I can't move anybody. So
I can start moving first. And yes, Nadine, Reva, you should be able to move yourselves.
Yeah, okay. Looks like I can move myself. So we can, it's okay to join now?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Reva, do you see it? If you click on breakout.
I see it. I can see a join for the copy.
Yeah, that's what you want.
I just wanted to make sure that there, I know Portia and others are able to join and in this. And then, and I just didn't want it to be leaving until the last minute. So everybody, you were having to shovel everybody over there in the last 2 seconds.
Elise, can you invite me to the room? I'm just assigned to the NSBO staff breakout.
Sure.
Thank you.
Hopefully you have an invitation now, Alexander.
Yep, I got it. Thanks.
At least mine says to wait to be assigned.
Okay, I will move you there.
Hi, Elisa and Chris. I just wanted to know we're still live. We're still resolving the issue.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hey, Elise, this is Skip. I'd like to be admitted when you get to that part of the golden ticket list. Thank you.
And hi, Elise. This is Margaret Martinosi, likewise for me. Thanks,
Margaret.
Elise, this is Portia. I'd like to get moved, please. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Elise, this is May Aiden. Can I be moved as well?
Chris, you may need to relaunch Zoom so your sound works better.
Please, could you also
I do sound normally the host of this, I should
to the room.
Your audio is no good, Chris.
Madam Chair, we are streaming and recording.
Thank you. I'd like to welcome everybody back. And I will turn now to Julia Phillips, the Chair of the Committee on National Science and Engineering Policy, to give us a committee report.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Moving between rooms was a little disconcerting there. All right. Thank you, Ellen. The Committee on National Science and Engineering Policy met in open session on Monday, November 29th. After approving minutes from the various meetings that we had over the course of the summer, we discussed the board's indicators messages draft document and a first product from the nurturing talent team in SEP. That product is a one-pager, which is focused on reducing financial barriers for STEM doctoral students with a focus on the missing millions and those from low socioeconomic backgrounds. And we'll come to back to that in relatively few minutes. With regard to SEP's efforts on the 2022 indicators suite of releases of thematic reports, I'm really pleased to share that since our August board meeting, three additional reports from the 2022 cycle have been released. Of course, many of you on the board have seen those various thematic reports. And thank you all for your critical input, which has really helped improve and sort of finally polish those publications. Those three reports that were published most recently include the STEM labor force of today, scientists, engineers, and skilled technical workers, academic research and development, and publication output, U.S. trends and international comparisons. You also know that the board has voted to give its final approval of the Higher Education in Science and Engineering thematic report, which is planned for release in February of 2022. There's another upcoming report on invention, knowledge transfer, and innovation that is expected to come to you all for final approval right after this meeting, so don't go off email completely. And the remaining thematic reports for the 2022 cycle will come forth for your consideration in the winter and spring, with planned releases periodically through May as we complete the entire cycle of the 2022 thematic reports associated with 2022 indicators. Okay, now I'd like to turn to the indicators messages document, which is going to come out from the board. Since our last meeting, the SEP committee and the board reviewed and approved the State of U.S. Science and Engineering, commonly referred to as the summary report. So the statutory delivery of that summary report will occur on January 18th, and it will include diverse outreach to key stakeholders, as it always does. The format will be a bit different this year, but we do that and on this regular biannual cycle. You'll hear about the rollout in more detail in the report from the Committee on External Engagement, which comes up next. In this cycle of indicators, for the first time, we, the board, are also distributing a companion piece, a board messages, a document, which complements the policy neutral summary report. The intent is to have a product in which the board's key take-home policy messages related to indicators data can be published electronically and in print. In past cycles, those policy messages were discussed during the indicators rollout presentation in various venues, but they were not captured in a document that could be disseminated easily to stakeholders or that they could take with them. The working title of the take-home piece is "The U.S. is a Keystone of Global Science and Engineering." As discussed in several meetings over the course of the year, this policy product reflects Vision 2030 priorities, while bringing forward updated key data from indicators, some of which is very recently available. The central message for our stakeholders is the importance of strategic, sustained U.S. focus on key areas, developing, attracting, and retaining both diverse domestic and international STEM talent, critical technologies, basic research, and partnerships and collaboration. Those are necessary to ensure that the U.S. holds and strengthens its position as a keystone of the global science and engineering ecosystem. Today, we're going to discuss the draft content of this piece, including text and figures, and that was shared with you by email and is in your board book. After the discussion, we will update the content and we'll plan to hold a board vote to approve the final fully designed piece by email before winter break. The document we're discussing now is still moving through a design process, as is kind of apparent as you look at it. So as we get your input, please note that the final piece will take care to ensure that all the figures, all the legends, all the captions, titles, et cetera, are readable and clear. Our media contractors are currently working on the design for the piece with the goal of having an accessible and engaging look and feel that also visually echoes Vision 2030 to emphasize that tie. We have an initial preview to share with you today. So I understand that there is a screen to be shared.
Julie, I hope you all can see this.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm just going to quick, this is Reba, I'm just going to quickly show you the, I'll zoom in a minute, but this is a sense of how it, the final piece will echo the vision look and feel. And then if I zoom in a little bit more, you can see it a little clearly. This is, again, a first pass at the fully designed piece. And then if we scroll down here, you can start to see where we're bringing in the data. And again, this is all of what you see. The content of this is what you see in the piece that's in your board book. So the missing millions figure, for example, the K-12 education piece. And then sort of here's a piece on geography. So we can't show all of it right here because some of the data is still in the embargo. But I just wanted to give you a sense of what the overall piece looks like.
Great. Thank you, Rabia. It's nice to see. You can very clearly see visually the connection to Vision 2030. So that's very nice.
So, and we'll be, like I said, we'll be looking at incorporating all of your comments in this and for the next draft of the piece. And when we hopefully will be able to share with you the fully designed piece for further input. And then, of course, for the final vote.
Right. Okay, and again, be prepared to see this for final approval before the winter break. So, okay, thank you for that. And now let's turn to the draft content. The piece begins with the importance of STEM talent. That's been a running theme through many board conversations over the course of the last couple of years and longer than that. We start with nurturing domestic talent, and we focus on the need to develop all of our diverse domestic talent, including the missing millions, individuals from lower socioeconomic status groups, and from every part of the country, every state, every county. We begin at the K-12 level, and we continue all the way through to the doctoral level. The document's narrative places an emphasis on the need for stronger K-12 STEM education and financial support to increase access to higher education for all. Again, themes that the board has been emphasizing for well over a year now. Key data include the associate's and bachelor's degrees by field and sex over time. They show that women continue to be underrepresented in some fields, such as engineering, and those are just the fields that are required for research and careers in many critical and emerging technologies. We've also included the striking underrepresentation of many racial and ethnic minorities across many of these S&E fields at the doctoral level. And we make the case that as S&E leaders and policymakers, we should work to make all levels of higher education an attractive, inclusive, and financially sustainable choice for individuals from all backgrounds. Next, we go from there to depict the variation in the geography of innovation in the US, including the distribution of the STEM workforce, locations of institutions of higher education receiving the most federal R&D funding, and states with the highest patent production per capita. And we note which states were EPSCoR eligible in 2019. These data show that there are opportunities to capitalize on existing science and engineering strengths in every state, not necessarily every county, but every state, to ensure that the economic growth that follows investment in science and engineering can be felt everywhere. But we also need to know that in addition to fostering domestic talent, the US must continue to welcome international students and workers, individuals who are key contributors to the science and engineering enterprise now and into the future. We cannot afford to lose ground on this wonderful asset. Many fields are heavily dependent on international talent. And for example, the US grants more doctoral degrees in engineering to temporary visa holders than it does to citizens and permanent residents. And the US does not merely train international talent. In fact, most US educated foreign science and engineering doctorate holders then remain in the US for many years and indefinitely, and are employed in the same fields in which they received their degrees, most often in the private sector. Finally, The document calls for strategically focusing U.S. efforts to remain a keystone of global science and engineering discovery and innovation. It emphasizes the value of knowledge and technology-intensive industries, which advance many critical and emerging technologies. We note that these industries depend on foreign-born talent for over a quarter of their STEM workforce, while at the same time, women and many racial and ethnic groups continue to be underrepresented in those jobs. The draft then connects the success of these industries to our country's dedication to sustained investment in basic research. The U.S. continues to be by far the world's largest funder of basic research, which is a key strength of our science and engineering enterprise, and Ponch gave some fabulous examples of that earlier today. The final figure highlights the web of collaboration in international COVID-19 publications as a striking example of the U.S. as a keystone of science and engineering, collaborating across regions and countries as the central node in the worldwide research effort to end the pandemic. When the committee met last week, we discussed a previous draft of this document, and several key points were raised. First, the committee had a robust discussion on the importance of addressing barriers to STEM entry associated with low socioeconomic status. We discussed the need for that issue to be more clearly featured in this document without losing focus on the missing millions. So the document you're seeing today has been revised to thread that issue throughout the piece alongside the data on sex, race, and ethnicity. And after the release of indicators, the committee will explore what data we may have to better understand how disparities and socioeconomic status impact participation in STEM education and careers, with a particular eye to broadening the geography of innovation in the United States. In addition to this topic, we heard good suggestions of where we should clarify and streamline the narrative and have revised the draft you see accordingly. At this point, I'd like to open the floor to hear your thoughts on the draft piece. Does the content hit the mark? We are mindful of keeping the piece relatively short. I think the current goal is 8 pages, but I'd like to hear if we are missing key messages or key points that need to be included. Don't all speak at once.
Thanks for all the hard work.
Yeah, I'll just say I thought it was a very good summary, of the key themes. And it pointed out some of the things that maybe didn't come through with the overall NCSCS look, where you look a little more closely at some of the disciplines, you know, that where there's bigger disparities than in other disciplines and those that are critical technologies to the U.S. So overall, I thought as you went through the document, it was a very good summary of what's included in indicators.
I mean, it is apparent from all of these conversations that there is so much more that needs to be said, and everything is connected to everything else. So it's very difficult to present something. Well, you really can't do sound bites, but even trying to keep it brief and relatively simple so that you can tell a good story is very challenging. And I think the team has done an amazing job of that. And it will be the work of the board going forward, working with NCSES and the board office to identify areas where subsequent one-pagers or maybe slightly longer pieces can amplify some pieces that we want to hit harder and persistently. Any other comments? Well, hearing none, there will be a short chance, I think, at the end of this session, if anything occurs to you in the meantime. I'm pleased to have a little time to talk also about policy products. The SEP committee has been working on a number of policy products. Some of them are out, like the K-12 education one pager. But most recently, the SEP has been dedicating a lot of effort, and actually this has been going on for over a year now, to the development of a policy piece on the topic of nurturing domestic science and engineering talent. I'm particularly would like to recognize Suresh Babu, Artie Bienenstock, and Suresh Garamella for their leadership and really intense engagement on this priority item. It's such a large beast that it's been challenging to identify points of entry, but I think we're in a really good spot for this first piece, probably only the first of many other pieces and other things to come afterwards. As we had discussions with the NSF leadership, the nurturing talent team, we determined that the focus of their first piece in this area would be on the financial barriers facing doctoral students, and that piece would be aimed towards congressional and administration stakeholders. A current draft for this one pager is in your board book, and the decision to develop this as a one pager emerged from conversations that the nurturing talent team had with NSF leaders, who provided an initial review. Their feedback, as well as feedback we received from SEP members at our meeting last week, is now reflected in the draft. And we'd particularly like to thank Karen Marangel and the EHR leadership team for their thoughtful engagement with us on this topic and for their input. The recommendations in the one pager are to increase support for federally funded doctoral students by increasing stipends and by providing non-stipend support, such things as healthcare, parental leave, childcare, and professional development. These recommendations are aimed at ensuring that doctoral STEM education is a sustainable option for all, particularly for the missing millions who disproportionately have little to no intergenerational wealth to support their educational pathways and/or family obligations and dependents. These recommendations cover all doctoral students and are aimed at moving the needle on participation for the missing millions and for individuals from low socioeconomic backgrounds, as well as for the many who carry significant student debt from their undergraduate studies. I found the data in this one page to be really compelling and shocking, actually. The recommendations in the one pager were developed from extensive research done by the team, which covered major reports from the national academies, scientific societies, et cetera, journal papers, federal statistical and financial data, media reports covering higher education in the mainstream and education press, and input that the board has heard from our external panelists during our many outstanding sessions over the past year. One-pagers are particularly nice for communications vehicles, because they enable us to reach stakeholders, but they don't have much real estate, which makes providing a full set of citations on the document itself very challenging. Therefore, we plan to provide a comprehensive list of references summarizing the research base for these recommendations as an accompanying document, which will be available for download from the board website once we approve and issue the one pager. In addition, updated data from the newest edition of NCSES's Survey of Earned Doctorates have just become available this past week. The data shown in the one pager will be updated accordingly immediately after this meeting. The team will also work with our media contractors on all figures drawn here to improve clarity, addressing points raised by several members of the board. We would be grateful for your review and thoughtful and thoughts on the current draft and the proposed recommendations. SEP staff will reach out for your feedback via email immediately after the board meeting. And after over a year of effort on this topic, we are really excited to be moving forward on this key issue impacting STEM doctoral students and ultimately moving the board's vision on developing our domestic STEM talent forward. And as I said, I think this is the first of multiple products in this area. We look forward to really enriching the discussion and doing everything in our power to keep it at the forefront of the minds of policymakers who have the opportunity to make changes in these areas. Does anyone have any questions or comments on this on the one pager or the topic in general?
And so if we have a little bit of feedback, did you say you were going to solicit it via email or we should just send it?
We
in?
Will be. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That would be fine. And yeah. So nothing burning apparently. Okay. Well, thank you all for a productive session. In addition to the comments on the financial barriers one pager and a vote on the innovation thematic report, following further revision and design later this month, you will receive an email requesting your approval of Board Messages companion piece, the companion piece release. So we will be your pen pals. And we are looking forward to an exciting and impactful Indicators 2022 release, as well as your input as we finalize the Nurturing Talent One Pager for approval and dissemination. That concludes my report.
Thank you very much, Julia. Let me just see if there are any other questions you've asked a couple of times, but want to make sure before we move on.
Great work, Julia. Thank you.
It's a great team, and boy, such good material. I mean, you know, you'd have to have to be brain dead not to be able to work with it.
Yeah, and I'll second the comments that are being put in the chat. Really represents a lot of work, a lot of thinking and reasoning and trying to understand how to best get some of the messages and recommendations across. So thank you very much. Well, let's see. We are a few minutes early, but I believe we can go ahead and start the external engagement committee. So let me turn to Suresh Babu and as the new chair of the Committee on External Engagement to report on the committee's meeting, which was held earlier today before our plenary. And Suresh, thank you again for taking on this responsibility.
Thank you, Ellen. I'm just doing a mic check. Can you all hear me? Okay. Thank you, Ellen. The External Engagement Committee met this morning. The members of the External Engagement Committee are Dario Gill, who is also the vice chair of the committee, Roger Beachy and Maureen Kondik and Ken Fox and Heather Wilson. During our meeting this morning, we reviewed rollout plan for NSB Science and Engineering Indicators Report and discussed potential NSB engagement activities for the next 6 months and discussed the plans for February external panel too. I'll give you a brief overview of each of this and one after another, and I'll pause between each one of the engagement plan and invite your feedback from the board before moving to the next topic. The first one, we are talking about the Science and Engineering Indicators 2022 draft rollout plan, and it is in your board book also. The committee discussed engagement plans for release of the upcoming State of the US Science and Engineering Indicators Report, which summarizes how the country is doing in SNE and places US performance in a global context. As you know, NSB must deliver this report to Congress and also White House by January 18th, 2022. The plan includes activities we have completed for the four 2022 indicators reports that NSB has already published, as well as a lot of engagement activities that will happen in January. So let me walk you through the planned activities, engagement activities for January. The first one is a virtual briefing for members of the media. For the last 10 years or so, NSB has offered this pre-briefing for the press. So this typically results in a good coverage of the NSB key messages about indicators. So coverage on the past included the Washington Post, CNN, and Forbes, and among others too. So that's the first one. The second one is a private briefing for OSTP and OMB. Currently, NSB staff are exploring whether the White House officials prefer a virtual or in-person briefing. It's to be determined yet. The third engagement is a private briefing for Congressional Science Committee staff. This cycle, this will most probably virtual, private, bipartisan, and bicameral briefing, and as in past cycles, gives the congressional staff an opportunity to talk with SAP chair and also the NCSS Indicators Program Director and other participants. So this allows them to go deep dive into the data and answer more detailed questions than it is feasible in a public briefing. So its idea is to have much more dialogue there. That's the private briefing also. The fourth one is a public briefing to the broader SNE community. This includes other congressional committee and personal staff, and also the representative of scientific and higher education groups, other federal agencies, and the briefing would like most likely be virtual, and that's what the current plan is. Then the next, after that public briefing, we'll also do a lot of media interviews with board members. I believe you heard before, Julia did also, and about indicators and policy implications, including state-based media also. So these are the activities. The plan also lays out potential activities that extend into summer 2022. That includes video clips of board talking about indicators and Vision 2030, and also additional meetings and briefings with a range of groups, publicity and engagement on the additional indicators reports that NSB will publish on a rolling basis from February through May. And this is all going to be happening also. And many of the committee members of the EE noted that we need to engage with representatives from scientific societies, higher education associations, and universities, as well as other federal agencies such as USDA, NIH, and DOE also. Let me pause here to ask if other board members have feedback or questions about these plans, the rollout plans. Julia, as SAP chair, do you have any comments or additions to this rollout plan? Julia?
That's very consistent with what I've been aware of and have been discussing. And aside from the change from in-person to virtual on some of the things, it sounds consistent with what we've done in the past. I do like the idea of trying to hit the state and the more local media, as well as the national and the kind of Washington-based media. I think that's very important.
Thank you, Julia. This came about with personal, in-person or virtual meeting also, and Nadine and Reba, any elaborate on that also, the selection of virtual?
It depends. Logistics are always interesting, but you know, whatever works. I mean, I think there, if in-person works, there is an impact that you don't necessarily get with the virtual, but the virtual can attract a much larger audience. And so a judicious mix of the two is probably nice if you can manage it.
Okay, thank you. Any other discussions? Since I can't see the participant list, please help me out here. There's any questions or discussions on this rollout?
I'm not seeing any raised hands right now, Suresh.
Thank you, Nadine. I appreciate it. So thank you, Julia, for the feedback. And also now, if you're okay, I would like to shift to the next part of this report. It's called the near-term engagement plans. So building on the media and congressional plans the board reviewed earlier this year, and using NSB's new strategy tool we all have been gone through, the committee also discussed other near engagement plans for a lot of goals over the next 6 months and covering broad engagement and specific meetings with the Congress. The proposed engagement activities around indicators, NSF merit review digest, K-12 STEM student performance and opportunity gaps, and Vision 2030 are all being discussed about it.
For the potential congressional meetings, the overarching goal is to develop long-term relationship to hear firsthand about various congressional concerns and priorities, and also discuss mutual areas of interest, including mission priorities of, and also delivering research benefits, developing STEM talent, and expanding the geography of innovation. So remember, this is our vision 2030, so that's going to be engagement activities also. So you'll see that for each potential meeting in the table, we have NSV members listed who would potentially participate as teams in these meetings, which we assume will be virtual, at least for the near future. And depending upon NSV member interest and availability and on the evolving political landscape, NSV staff may suggest that we pivot to other meetings, including the additional NSF appropriators and authorizers too. So let me pause for a moment, and this is for the table two where we are, you know, engaging with congressional members. And let me open up for discussion. What do you think about this near-term engagement goals? Is there some missing we should be sure to do in the next 6 months? Also, if you are not listed in our congressional meetings and would like to participate or volunteer, please let us know. So let me pause for a moment here, and it's open up for the discussions. Like to see, okay, now I can see participant list. Anybody would like to?
Ellen,
please, yeah. Go ahead.
I just wanted to make sure I understood the list because there's you know, gray lines between some groups. So is that saying like the first group is sort of the highest priority and then there's a couple of other groups, you know, after that? Am I reading that right?
Or? If I could just jump in. Yeah, no, that actually just, it's dividing up. It's not listed in any priority. It's senators, okay. Then you got reps, then you've got caucuses and such, committees and such. That's all that signifies.
Yep. Okay. So I guess what would help me, especially since my name shows up a lot, is just trying to think through, okay, in a certain, so we'll kind of get through the indicators briefings and then we'll sort of look at this list to understand, okay, kind of in what order, what priority we should be thinking about those and working on them. Just, you know, I think that will help, certainly help me and probably other people as well to understand sort of the time frame.
Thank you, Ellen. That's a working document, so we'll keep updating that. Thank you. And I have a list. Scott, go ahead, please.
I just wanted to throw in Brad Sherman's our local congressman for us. He's on the Space and Science Committee or Science and Space Committee. Probably would want to add that. But as far as the whole process goes, are we waiting for coordination? Do we move out on our own on this?
So can you, Nadine, and Reba, can you help me out here?
Sure, I can briefly, and Reba can add. We would be reaching out to members to, first of all, gauge availability and interest. As Ellen said, there's a lot here and obviously you can't do it all at once. And so part of this that's part of what will evolve. That depends on your all's availability and interest as well as the other side, you know, in terms of who's up for meetings. So we will definitely be reaching out to you working with EE.
And also other members have provided email, like they could think about this potential outreach. Please do that. Please send it to Nadine and Reba too.
Go ahead. Sorry, let me just answer Scott. Also, we do prep, when we do these things, we set them up for you. And then we also provide prep material, meeting memos and so forth so that, you know, to help facilitate those meetings and to have those conversations. So you'll definitely have support for as these things go forward and we set up meetings. And if you're participating in any of them, you'll have our staff support to help you with that. So just to clarify.
Thank you, Reba.
I was assuming, but I wanted to make sure.
Thank you. Aaron, please.
Yeah, this is great, Suresh. Here's another question or way to look at the network here. And so this list here of members and people to meet, I think is very logical. Another network is based on the individual people and where they live and who their connections are already, and also their local reps. Probably most of us meet regularly with, you know, our Congress people and have a relationship with them for things that we're doing in our lives outside of the NSB. So just putting that out there.
I think, thank you, Aaron. Probably NSB staff would probably help you in that also. I've always reached out to them. If there is a need, they can always provide guidance on how to do it. So Reba and Nadine, I spoke for you both. You're okay with that?
Absolutely. And to Aaron's point, yes, we definitely also look through the lens of where members are located geographically and leveraging those connections. But please do let us know, as Suresh said, if you're not on here and you have connections, as Scott just said, that you'd like to see happen, that would be great.
I'll just pipe in and say that yes, if you already have those relationships or people that you know about that you would like to think about visiting in your context as an NSB member, please let us know. But if those, of course, you may have and probably do have connections that we can't divine just from your location base, but that you know you have a history with somebody, we would love to get that information from you, and we can include that in our matrix so that we're able to help with those facilitating that for the NSB meetings.
So it might be helpful to start a spreadsheet or some kind of tool to collect that information from members, and you can build the network that way.
So we actually have that spreadsheet, and that's a great idea to share that with you all, and you could make any corrections or update it.
Thank you. Aaron. And Victor's hand is up.
Victor. Thank you, Suresh. I appreciate it. To Aaron's comment, Nadine, yes, share that spreadsheet, because the other thing that can happen is a lot of us have a lot of informal meetings with people. And so we can be force multipliers in terms of amplifying the message. You know, so I may sit around with the same group of people that Suresh hangs with or Ponch and say, oh, yes, those things are important. But the other thing I just wanted to emphasize, and this is way off because it's about another 5 months away, is to think a little differently in terms of planning the awards banquet and how can we use that as a network, major network function to bring people in that we see as influencers and extremely important to our vision 2030 that we may not have included or that may not have been part of our network, and just to use that event. That's something far off, but it's a great opportunity.
Thank you, Victor. Appreciate it. Suresh, hand up. Suresh G.
Yeah, just maybe just a slight caution, and that is a lot of us going off and talking to a lot of people. We should be careful, and we can sometimes do more harm than good. And so I think definitely staying very closely connected with Nadine and others is important. So I just raised the caution. I also think, and maybe this comes in a different place in your presentation, but sometimes it's not us talking to the senators and congressmen, but bringing along a high school group or a college, you know, some students or some entrepreneurs or something like that in our neighborhood. So I think there's a lot of thought and care that needs to go into these things. I'm assuming, Reba, that you also staff these if somebody comes along, so that if there's a lot of follow-up action, we track that too. So there's just a lot of discipline needed here, and it could go sideways if you're not careful. So I'm sorry if I sound but just thought I'd put that out there.
Just to reassure you, Suresh, yes, these are coordinated by us, and there's always staff who come along and help because they are NSB meetings.
That's great.
Yes, and now if Raven wants to add anything on that.
All I was going to say was we do, of course, and I think Suresh will talk about this in a little bit, but these kind of in-state activities, right, where we might, as you were saying, could bring, brought in in the past NSF-funded researchers, NSF-funded students to be part of the conversation to talk. I know we, with the director, we did one while he was still on the board and at ASU, and he hosted one of those, and it was a terrific event to do exactly what you said. And so we look forward to doing some more of those, and perhaps we should do one in Vermont.
Thank you, Reba. So, Suresh, I think most of the times I tell you that we have to work as a one unified voice, and make sure, please, please coordinate with NSB staff. They know how to prepare you for this meeting. So with that, I'm going to punch. You have your hands up.
No, I just want to second what Suresh said, the consistency in messaging. I think I'm hearing that it's going to be the case. That is fantastic. One of the things that you might want to leverage is, I know that Nadine, you work very well with Amanda and the team. We have a lot of things that we are, you know, communicating with the congressional folks. So we just want to make sure that, not that you have to, the message doesn't have to be, you know, the message can be the NSB message, but I think it'd be good to always synchronize so that, you know, you know what we have been saying and you know, we know what you're saying. So I think it's all good to play from the same playbook. To Reba's point, I think the most powerful thing that we have is our universities in the different states. And so, you know, when we talk about Suresh in Vermont, I think leveraging our universities who have great relationships with the congressional delegations and the local legislators and the governors and the cities even is extremely powerful. So Heather, Suresh, you know, these folks can be tremendously valuable. Likewise through them, and you know, I can also help us to reach out to other presidents, you know, may make our life much easier than trying to go in and do it ourselves. Because they have these machines in these universities that are in constant communication with their legislative teams. So I think, you know, we may want to leverage that, is all I was trying to say. That might get the messages even more effectively, you know, in different parts of the country. Thanks.
Thank you, Panch. So I believe I'm looking at any other discussions. So I think, Panch, your comment is well taken. So unified messaging, coordinating with you, and also coordinating the university presidents. I completely agree. I think I have to give credit to Nadine and Reba. So they have always been walking along with me. Even when we did the Tennessee session also, they helped us quite a lot. Reba, Nadine, you want to comment on coordination, anything, or we can continue forward?
Yeah, just very briefly, because I know we're running out of time, just that to Pancha's point that, yes, we very much closely coordinate with the LEDGE team in OPA, which is a terrific relationship, so that we keep each other informed and make sure we are on both sides aware of what are we doing, who are we meeting with, what are we talking about.
Thank you. So lastly, the committee also today discussed the plans for NSB February external panel. Let me turn to Roger, who is going to lead this panel initiative to give a brief overview. Roger, please take it away.
Yeah, thanks, Suresh. I hope you all enjoyed the panel earlier today. The February panel will continue to work to inform us and to motivate action on expanding the geography of innovation, building on our two most recent panels. It will highlight the S&E industry and private sector partnerships and the elements of regional development and innovation. We would ask the panelists speak about what works rather than what doesn't work. That's also informative. For example, to create public-private partnerships that leverage regional S&T expertise and interests. Secondly, to look for someone who can help to catalyze regional workforce development and economic impact, and somebody else who knows about creating sustainable enterprise and innovation over the long term. Our hope is that Dario Gill would host this panel, given his his industry expertise and connections. I didn't see him on the discussion list here. I'm not sure if Dario is there. The committee then brainstorm ideas for potential speakers. And at this point, we welcome your suggestions, in particular for speakers that would speak to private public partnerships and what works to spur innovation in regions across the country. We'd like to have some geographical diversity in doing this in those communities where innovation, enterprise, has been successful, what's made for good success, and perhaps what hasn't worked. So Dario or Dan, given that you're very much connected to the private sector, if you have some speakers that you'd like to suggest at this point, or to be back in touch with Alexandra and Nadine and Reba, or okay, with us.
Roger, I'll definitely give it some thought.
That'd be great. It would be really useful to have input from the board that we might not have run across in our other searching. Other suggestions from others on the board for ideas? Artie, I almost saw your hand go up. Yeah.
I have forgotten the name of the woman at the University of California, Berkeley, who wrote the book Regional Advantage, describing what happened in the Bay Area compared to what happened in Massachusetts. I just admire her work enormously, and I'll send you her name.
Thank you. Very good, thanks. Other suggestions? Alexandra, do you want to add anything more? She's been a real productive person who's helped us in the office, from the office staff.
No, I think you touched on everything. We will be looking forward to hearing further recommendations from the board members, and the staff has maintained a list of all recommendations as they've trickled through for different panels.
Okay.
And it's a list that we have at our disposal and we'll be maintaining for future panels as well.
Great, thanks very much. And again, with please be in contact if someone comes to mind that can be helpful to the rest of us. These panels are really valuable for me in particular, hope for others in learning what we don't know. So with that, back to you, Suresh.
Thanks, Roger. So we look forward to seeing you all in February yes. panel when it comes together. And it'll be very compelling. So this is one of the things I always look for listening. And that concludes my report out. Back to you, Ellen.
Thank you very much, Suresh. And I want to thank everybody who made day one in our new format go smoothly. Tomorrow, the National Science Board will reconvene in open session at 11 a.m. Eastern, and we hope everyone out there will join us then. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all. See you tomorrow.
Bye-bye.
All right.